Loveline is meant for an adult audience. Loveline may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion advised.
Now, here's Loveline.
1-800-LOVE-191.
With Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla.
What? Are you insane?
Hey, it's Loveline. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. I'm Adam Carolla. That be Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew?
Coffee.
He's the one coughing in the background. Board certified physician, addiction medicine specialist.
Yeah. How was your fourth?
I had a good time. I went to the beach and did things that I rarely do and enjoyed them.
I did too.
I was sort of forced to play volleyball.
Yeah.
And I flew a kite.
I did too.
But there were like gale force winds.
Yeah, there were. Yeah.
And it was one of these Japanese fighting kites and I almost killed a family. I mean, I don't know if anyone's ever messed around with one of these serious kites.
With two strings?
Yeah, there's two strings, and you control the thing. Yeah. It's a left and right pattern.
Yeah.
But the kite is made out of some sort of composite Kevlar material, and the poles are basically made of what a good fishing rod is made out of. And the thing has nylon cord on it, which you could probably pull a tiger shark up onto a ship with. It's strong enough. And when the wind gets kicking and you don't know what you're doing and you got a couple beers in you, look out. You could kill somebody with one of these things.
Yeah, yeah.
They dive violently.
Yeah.
And the thing got out of control a few times and there's people just sort of picnicking on the beach and I almost killed a family.
Nice.
Yeah. A friend of mine hit this guy from like Hungary or something. I was really pissed. Yeah. And then I commented to my friend, you know, I said, it's funny that guys in Speedos rarely have a sense of humor. And I thought to myself, you know, guys in Speedos, especially the ones with, you know, the red and blue stripes on them, like this guy was sporting, should really have a tremendous sense of humor. If you think about it, you're walking around in something less than underpants.
Yeah.
It's like wearing your kid brother's jockey shorts with a drawstring in them, and they're bright red. And you're on the beach, but you have no sense of humor. Guys with Speedos typically have no sense of humor, and like I said, I really think they should be amongst the most gregarious society has to offer.
What else you do?
I didn't really see any fireworks.
How come?
Well,
nobody's allowed to put them off anymore anywhere.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone notices. It's funny that we celebrate this country's independence by not being able to do a bunch of stuff. It's really funny because there's one day a year that you want to do stuff.
Yeah.
You want to bring your dog on the beach. You want to bring a 12-pack out to the beach. You want to light off a few firecrackers. There's a whole bunch of stuff that you want to do that you can't do on this one day, and that's the Independence Day. It really struck home with me. Poor Ann had to drive to Canada so she could find a stretch of a beach big enough for a dog to crap on because it's illegal for her to bring her dog anywhere else.
Yeah.
I had this big sack of fireworks that Darren from Goldfinger gave me. It was burning a hole in my hand. I wanted to light these things off so badly. I couldn't find a place to do it. There's cop cars everywhere. There's highway patrol everywhere. Finally, we came back to the valley. We went to this this school. It was, you know, four or five houses down from my buddies. It was just a big empty schoolyard, you know, big asphalt schoolyard like they have out in the valleys. Lit one, like, bottle rocket off, and one of the neighbors, this pint-sized woman in her 60s, just came storming out of her house screaming about calling the cops. And we're all adults, mind you. There's 20 of us at this point. We all just put our, you know, tails between our legs and run back to the house, scared. And I thought to myself, what a way to celebrate the independence of this country. One old yenta comes out of the house, threatens to call the cops, and we all go running back into the house. So I do sort of learn that there's a whole bunch of stuff you can't do on the independence.
Yeah.
And they're really, hey, you younger people, you don't know how miserable you are. Let me tell you, when I was a kid, you just did what you wanted.
Well, you for months planned the different packets you were going to get of fireworks.
Yeah.
Remember those you know, had fancy
right.
names.
Right. Dad would go over to the Red Devil stand and buy a box of stuff, and then, like, Uncle Jack would come over, and he'd be three sheets to the wind. You know, he'd be doing a thing where he's dumping part of his beer onto the barbecue and making the flame come up, and then he'd get good and loaded, and then he'd come out and start lighting stuff off, too. But the 4th of July was about getting drunk and lighting stuff off.
Yeah.
Now there's sobriety checkpoints every 10 feet. If you got a sparkler under your seat, you're going to do hard time. That's ridiculous. There's just no fun anymore. I mean, you know what I mean?
Listen,
a couple of people lose their fingers each year. Is that such a crime? You know what I'm saying? I mean, you can't even be trusted as an adult to responsibly light off fireworks.
Yeah.
What the hell kind of... Is this what our founding fathers had in mind?
No.
It's ridiculous. And I say a kid's thumb once, twice a year, big deal. That's a small price to pay. You know what I'm saying? You could lose it doing anything. Why do we go nuts on fireworks? I mean, think about it.
Yeah.
I swear to God, this secondhand smoke, you hear me complaining about this, but I'll tell you, once a year, we wind up this fireworks, anti-fireworks juggernaut, and it's the biggest campaign in the country. How many people do you know who actually been hurt or maimed by fireworks?
Yeah. I don't know the data, but I'm sure it's compelling.
Clay raised his hand. There's only four fingers on him over there. Oh, okay, so everyone knows. Everyone knows someone who took a bottle rocket in the ass.
Did you? Wait, let him.
Listen, Clay. You know more people have been.
It
checked.
Was my brother. He almost lost a hand.
All right, but it's still on, right?
What was he lighting?
Yes, it is.
What was he lighting?
What'd he do?
What'd he do?
It was firecrackers. They were legal south of the border style.
That was like an M80
dynamite
or something.
No, just a big pack of firecrackers.
Huh.
All right, but your brother was screwing around, right?
He was like 10 years old, didn't know what he was doing.
All right, is he okay now?
He's all right, but he's like terminally scared of fireworks.
All right, but that's his problem. Why do I have to pay for your 10-year-old brother's F-up? And another thing, I guarantee you there's more kids screwed up by skateboards, rollerblades, jet skis.
Oh, yeah.
What about snowboarding?
Oh,
this has to be this one snowboard must maim more teenagers than drunk drivers each year.
Yeah.
You don't hear anyone complaining about this.
Yeah.
I'm an adult. Can't I light my goddamn fireworks off? Still got a big sack of those things. I don't know what to do with them now. I swear to God, there's no place you can go. And you people who think that Southern California, especially Los Angeles, is made up of a bunch of laid-back hippies, this is a police state. You don't believe me? I came outside this morning. My roommate had a parking ticket on his car.
In front of your house.
Sunday morning, everybody, the day after the 4th, 10 a.m. is when the ticket was marked. He was facing the wrong direction, parked right up against the wall, right in front of the house that he lives in. Oh, yes. Yes. Everyone else may be sleeping on a Sunday morning after the 4th, but not the meter maids. All right, Mike's enough of that. Drew?
Thank God Mike's back.
Did you do anything?
Went to the beach. Same stuff.
Did you have a good time?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, I did.
Play some volleyball or something?
No, I've been in the ocean. I used to be a lifeguard, believe it or not. And I went in the ocean. I've been in years. Felt good.
You know what struck me, too, about the 4th?
Hmm.
I needed to see fireworks yesterday badly. Like a heroin addict needs his heroin.
Yeah.
I mean, and I didn't see any all day. I saw some off the freeway on the ride home. I was going nuts. And I thought to myself, I really don't need to see fireworks any other day of the year. And I don't really even think about it. And if someone said, hey, they're having a big fireworks display at Dodger Stadium tonight for the homecoming game, I'd be like, yeah, screw you.
Yeah,
yeah, go ahead. I'm staying home. I'm going to watch MacGyver.
Yeah.
But yesterday, about 8:30 at night, I was like jonesing so badly for fireworks. I was about ready just to light my shoe on fire and just stare at it. I was going insane, and I saw a little bit about 10 miles away off the Ventura Freeway on the ride home at 10 o'clock.
Really,
and I was going nuts.
It is a ritual.
I know, and it's so sad that as an adult, when I can really blow stuff up, you know, when I was 10, sorry, Clay, I know your brother was 10 too, but phone screener Clay, by the way, when I was 10, I didn't have much power. It's whatever your folks would let you do, whatever they could afford, and you know, the Carolla family, there was certainly no pyrotechnics show going on there. There's like,
some snakes and sparklers.
My dad lit like a toilet paper roll on fire, and then Uncle Chet spit some Kamchatka on it, and that was about it. Now I have a whole big arsenal given to me by Darren, and I can't do an effing thing with it. Yeah. Just sit on it. I'm gonna poll the nation tonight, because I think we're way stricter here than any other part of the country.
Part of this came from the fact that we're in fire territory, and it's a bad fire year.
Oh, every year is a bad fire year.
Well, that's right.
Ever been a good fire year?
No, but that's why they've learned to crack down here.
Oh, please, a house or two burns, Clay's brother loses a hand, a small price to pay. Juliet, you're 17.
Yeah.
Come on, this is Hollywood, Drew.
Go ahead. Juliet?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got a question.
We're waiting.
All right. Hold on.
All right. Juliet, you're going to have to hang on yourself a little while there. So you can. Well, she's already been on. Juliet has been on hold for 74 minutes, everybody.
I couldn't quite get it together.
74 minutes.
Am I talking to you, Pinhead?
Mike?
Yeah.
You're 21.
No, I'm 31.
I mean 31. You know, I looked up and saw the 31 and just said 21 anyway.
You were so disturbed about your half.
Yeah, I cut your age in half.
Works for me.
What's up, Mike?
My cousin got in a really bad fireworks accident, and, you know...
Last night?
His face is pretty much disintegrated.
Last night?
Yeah.
What happened?
Wait, where's it calling from? Where are you calling from?
Illinois.
Really?
What happened?
What was the device?
A homemade mortar cannon kind of thing.
Oh, my God.
And it disintegrated the pipe.
It blew up in her face.
Well, she was standing away from it. It actually hit her from behind, but took out her face. And basically my question is that, you know...
Hold on a second. How does something hit you from behind and take out your face?
Well, it embeds under the skin in the back of your head and stays under the skin till it comes out the front of your face.
Oh, my God. It burns through.
Hold on a second. It burns through?
Stuff like that can happen.
What are you talking about?
I mean, there's things that get in one place end up moving around, exiting elsewhere.
At high speed, you mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
But maybe, it doesn't burn through. It just blasts through like a bullet, right?
Yeah, bullets do that.
So like a piece of shrapnel hit her in the back of the head and came out of the front of her head?
Ask him.
What line was that?
One.
Oh, all right. Mike?
Yeah.
Was it a piece of shrapnel?
Yeah, apparently so.
Burning phosphorus or something.
And it hit her in the back of the head and came out the front of her head?
Yeah.
And what happened to her?
Well, she's in the hospital right now, and they're planning on doing, you know, multiple reconstructive surgeries. Yeah. You know?
See what happens, Drew, every time I start mouthing off about something. But that's not fireworks. This guy made essentially a pipe bomb.
Yeah, yeah. This is way out of line.
And that's illegal in all, how many? 50, say?
But yeah.
Oh, that's horrible.
Boy.
This was way out of line, but it still happened.
This is your cousin?
What's that?
This was your cousin?
Yeah.
Is it he or she?
She.
Oh, God.
She's 19.
Yeah. And then what do they say?
Well, basically right now they're telling us she needs, like, you know...
Series of surgeries.
The whole side of her, from her nose back to her ear, is just a flap of skin that's just hanging there.
Yeah.
Okay. And they got a breathing out of tracheotomy, so she's not going to be eating for months.
Mm.
And, you know, I was looking for some kind of a help is pointing a direction as far as, you know, how do you lighten the spirits of someone like this, you know?
You know, leave him on.
He is on. Jesus Christ, Drew. How long have you done this show?
Yeah, I don't get to...
You don't get to hear him breathe?
Yeah.
All right.
And this is because the point I'm going to make is exactly that it's important just to be present for somebody like this.
Yeah.
And have everybody who loves and cares about this person remain very close for many months to come. Not to just go in and do a soft shoe and expect to lift her spirits or buy her roses. All that will be helpful. You want to keep things certainly as positive as you can, but
I was
recognize
looking more like for like a book that you would recommend to, you know.
Surviving. Oh.
Fireworks and
no,
surviving the fourth.
Hey, you know, definitely they will get...
Here's the angle I would work, I'll tell you. Seriously. If you think about this, think about how far cosmetic surgery reconstruction has come in the last... Well, since the Gabor sisters, really. But I mean, in the last 20 years, 30 years. I mean, think about this, Drew. If this kind of crap had happened to you, like, in the 50s, you'd be walking around with a big scar down your face, right?
Yeah.
In the 40s, 30s, right?
Yeah.
I mean, now you can make this stuff good as new, right? I mean, if you get a good surgeon.
Yeah, people are a little unrealistic about it. I mean, there's a lot that can be done.
Well, and plus you could get something done that you were thinking of getting done anyway.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
What the nature of the injury is here. Again, it sounds like they've removed the whole thing. It's off this side.
Is it off?
I haven't seen her yet.
Oh, Drew, how do you know? You don't know what's
that's,
off.
That's
is that what they do?
That's what he's describing.
Basically. No, he said it flapped back. They probably flapped it back and sewed it back.
Not, she's on a breathing machine via tracheostomy. Nothing in the mouth.
Yeah,
it's
that's
not
correct.
There.
Her whole her
jaw's
her
gone.
Gone. Her
eyes gone.
Who made this bomb? I mean, this mortar, by the way.
The idiot next door neighbor.
Yeah, eyes
is
gone,
this guy
too.
Brought up on charges?
Oh, yeah.
He was in custody for questioning whether or not the charges are forthcoming yet. I'm sure they are.
Something.
But. Oh, yeah. Imagine in Los Angeles, I think they just put a bullet in your head. I think the SWAT team just would actually just execute you right there. Imagine you get arrested for a sparkler. Yeah. You do something like this, they put
I
you
hope
down.
She, I, we don't know. I suppose my daughter has been a brain injury or anything, too, that might have been.
Listen, it's a horrible tragedy. Drew, what is there? I mean, you can't do anything. Just be present.
Be present. Get the Department of Social Services at the hospital. Get a psychological team together. And the family's going to need help. Everybody's going to need assistance with this. It's going to take a long, long time. And Adam, don't you just feel like a schmuck right now for having gone off that fireworks?
No, I don't. Because the fireworks that I was speaking of were legal in the other 49 states. Other than California, and are totally benign. This guy went out and got himself a mortar from a surplus store and made a bomb, essentially. Stuff I'm talking about is sparklers and flowers and things like that. Kyle.
Yeah.
You're 19.
That I am.
All right, but obviously I feel badly for her. Of course.
You have to apologize!
Okay, I'm sorry. No, listen, I don't wish that on my worst enemy. Maybe a couple of my neighbors.
Hey,
you're 18. What's up?
Hey, I have a lot of problems remembering things and like concentration and stuff.
Yeah, me like, too.
You had that your whole life?
Say it again.
You had that your whole life?
As far as I can remember, but it's probably not saying much. But yeah,
because you can't remember, is that what you mean?
Yeah.
So you've had a sudden decline in your capacity for memory. Is that right?
You say it again?
All right, hold on. This show's gonna go on for 45 minutes because we got Drew over here who talks like he's speaking the Queen's English, and then we got a retard over here who can't remember anything, and we're gonna chase our tails.
All right, go ahead. You
let me talk.
You take it.
Yeah. I'll work as a sort of intermediary.
Retard to retard. This is good.
Right, Dave.
Yeah.
You do any drugs?
No.
You ever get hit in the head?
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything big? Knocked out?
Lose consciousness?
No.
No. Okay. Were you always this way as far as you can remember?
Yeah.
And how do you do in school?
Well, it wasn't really good. I had a lot of trouble. Say I was doing work and stuff. I have a lot of trouble, remembering what the teacher says or whatever. Yeah. And then, I get really tired and have a lot of headaches and stuff.
Do you have anything that you do remember? Do you have a sport that you like?
Not really.
Have you seen a doctor for this?
I did once.
How long ago?
He doesn't remember.
I'd probably say within a year.
Okay.
I think she said that, I was sent to get a CAT scan.
Good.
Because they thought it was, probably something wrong like that.
And?
And, everybody came, they said there was nothing, they didn't find anything.
So the CAT scan was normal?
Yeah.
Have you been evaluated for a learning disability?
No.
That's what you ought to do. I mean, it seems to me you ought to keep going down that path, particularly if this is a new... They're very, very simple ways to evaluate.
What if you
this.
Find out you have a learning disability?
They can be treated now. They really can.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
How?
It depends what the disability is, but if you were in high school now, they would
I was?
Yeah, they'd take you and go, oh, Christ, what's the matter with this kid? And they'd evaluate, they'd give you neuropsych testing, and they'd evaluate what kinds of things can be done to help sort of recircuit your brain a little bit.
I didn't have anything wrong with me, though.
You just couldn't learn.
Well,
as far as you were concerned, you were fine.
No, I couldn't read because I never learned to read, and I was a horrible student, really sort of based on... Listen, being a student is no different than playing a sport in that, I suck at golf, and it's because I never played.
But they could detect that, they could maybe give you ways to overcome that, and
they could help my game out a little bit.
Well, they could focus
they could
on the
help
fundamentals,
my swing, but
right?
You know what? Let me tell you something. Never be half as good as someone
That's
who started
right.
early.
That's true.
So it was kind of lost cause anyway. Mm-hmm. But listen, we don't have to make everyone a good student. I was a god-awful student, and if they got to me and worked with me enough, I could have just been a bad or poor student. Still wouldn't have went to college, still would never.
You don't know that. Imagine you'd be ruling the world right now.
No. Listen, this
philosopher warrior.
Let me tell you something about college. Waste of time unless you're going to go to the next level. You want to be a doctor, a lawyer, you need your advanced degree, fine, do it. Other than that, it's just a bunch of nonsense.
I could not disagree with you more strongly.
I know. You think you learn how to learn. You think you learn how to...
Some people do.
...gather knowledge.
Some people do.
Idiots do. Police, Drew. It's no help. And with the internet, kids don't need it these days. Luke, you're 16.
What? Oh, Luke. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Adam... Okay, people don't realize how wise you are.
They don't, do they?
No.
They do.
My parents had this junior college guy house sit while we were on vacation last week, and one of my dogs died during that time.
That's right.
Yeah.
He probably tried to smoke his tail or something. Well,
the vet said he had cardiac myopathy.
Right, from blowing pot into his nose.
Yeah, I really think that. It's insane.
Oh, baby. How old was that mutt of yours?
He was 9.
9?
Yeah.
That's, more than 9 to you and me. I don't know how old that is. It's not that old in doggy years.
Yeah. Oh,
I'm sorry to hear that. He probably didn't even know he was dead. He probably walked him 3 times and crapped him once.
Wasn't a Great Dane or something, was it?
No, it was a lab.
Oh, that's a good dog, too, those labs.
Yeah, it was a good dog.
Black lab or chocolate?
It was the yellow.
Oh, the yellow lab. Yeah. That's nice. That's an old yeller.
Yeah.
Oh. What was his name?
Casey.
Oh, I miss that Casey.
It was too bad.
I miss my Lotsie.
I'm sorry.
I'm sure they're frolicking in heaven. I'm sure little Lotsie's sniffing Casey's ass on some huge farm. Becky.
Hi.
Hey, you're 25.
No, I'll be 21 on Wednesday.
I have no idea why I said 25.
Becky, what's going on?
Hi, I've been married for almost 4 years. Mm. Wait, no, 3. I have a 16-month-old son.
Oh, got married before the baby. What a novel.
No. We got married on October 13th, and we moved, and I got pregnant the next year.
Yeah, you have me married before the baby. It's a refreshing change.
What?
Go ahead.
All right, hold on a second. Hey,
hey
Becky. Becky,
pregnant.
Hold on a second. Becky? Becky?
Yeah.
I'm going to put you on hold and punish you for just a second, okay?
Okay.
Because Drew said, oh, you got married before the baby.
Mm.
And your response was, no.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Well, for being ultra defensive, I'm going to let you think about it for a minute. Stopping the show. Please, everybody, stop saying no to Drew all the time. Stop it. Every goddamn word that comes out of Drew's mouth, someone yells no. I got my kid's a year old. I've been married for
12 years.
12 years. Oh, you got married before the kid? No. Yes, you idiot. Please. All right, just hang tight there.
Hey, this is Carrot Top, and even losers like me listen to Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. Turn on your radio; they'll give you a big hug. It's Loveline. Get it?
Ow! We got a lot of mileage out of that Carrot Top drop. Carrot Top drop. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Forget about that fax number. You know I don't like reading. It's funny. People give me scripts and stuff, and they say, could you read this script? And I go...
put it on tape. That's what you told me. I have to write some books. Maybe me droning into a tape, that'll serve you right.
I didn't mean you put it on tape. I mean,
that.
You know, dig up Orson Welles.
Okay.
Or, you know, have Chuck Heston or something narrate it. Drew asked me today, I have a birthday coming up, and actually I have 2 coming up. Oh, no, it's just the one. And I just want to confuse the hell out of Sherry over there.
He hasn't been sober at all, don't worry.
I have a birthday coming up. Drew said he was wanting to get me a couple of books and what I read them. I don't know what it is about me, but I guess it's like I'm like a virgin that all the guys in high school want to nail. But as soon as I've announced to people, it'd be the greatest scam in the world. Those of you who enjoy reading, just announce to everybody that you don't much care for reading, and people go nuts. Oh, the wonders, the joys. And then they start telling you about how much they love reading, which is always like, hey, F you. You know, here's a story I get all the time. I tell people, hey, listen, I don't read very well. I have difficulty with it. It's not something I did well with in school, and I don't really enjoy it now. Oh, you don't know what you're missing. I could remember as a youth curling up in bed and reading in delight, you know, a Moby Dick or Steppenwolf or the
Tess,
Catcher in the Rye. Oh, this world that you don't know. And I'm like, hey, a-hole, I don't read. What, are you rubbing it in my face? Stop it.
Right.
You wouldn't do that if you're talking about, like, travel. Like, if you said to someone, yeah, I never been to Hawaii, I can't afford it. Oh, it's a tropical land
people
of wonderment.
They rub
that in your face?
Oh, sure.
Oh, screw them.
You've never been to Hawaii. You've never been?
Well, I guess if you have money, you can do that. But, I mean, to the person who has money. But if you don't, if the person's poor, it's kind of cruel.
Right.
Anyway.
Well, I have a couple things I wanted you to read I thought you would benefit from.
So what I tell you?
Get it on tape.
That's right. I'll listen to it in my car.
I recall getting you your Christmas gift was a
book about pies.
And Woody Allen.
Oh, Woody Allen.
I read that.
Oh, Drew read that?
I read his book.
Oh.
Where is that book?
All right.
And it was a trilogy, though. It was all of his written stuff.
Yeah, where is
Without
that?
Feathers.
Do I have
so
it?
So you took it?
No, he's got it.
Uh-oh.
But I read it.
No, you know, the pie book is nice because that's like a reference book. You know, you want to know the origins of pumpkin pie or something like that, you just look that up. All right, anyway, where were we, Drew?
Ryan.
Oh, yeah.
Let's go.
Oh, you're asking me about the MTV Movie Awards?
Oh, yeah.
When is that?
About a week.
No, I'm not going.
Okay.
It's my form of silent protest. Those a-holes, they don't treat Drew and I right at all. Didn't we go last year?
Yeah.
What did we do, sit in the very back?
Yeah.
People thought it was some kind of sketch.
Like we're
going to come down on a cable
right,
or something.
Right.
People kept saying, hey, what are you guys doing way back here?
Right.
They're like, this is the tickets they gave us.
You be doing something back here?
You doing something like, what do you do? Like hold up a banner or something? Nope, this is the seats we got. And they didn't want to give us tickets, did they? They didn't?
No.
Your wife wrestled it away from them?
Yep.
Didn't they say, like, hey, we don't have any more?
Right.
MTV's not real fond of their talent. I think MTV's take is, if you're on our network, you gotta suck. isn't that what they...
They'll make you feel.
You won't see any of their talent presenting anything or doing anything.
Uh-uh.
Like, if NBC had the NBC award show...
You'd see NBC talent.
Yeah.
They were promoting their
talent. Wouldn't you see Seinfeld on there handing something out?
I see all of them.
Yeah. MTV's kind of ashamed. And they call it talent, technically. I'm just giving it a label so that we can decipher what we're talking about here.
And I'm not referring to you guys.
No, that's true. There isn't much talent on the network, but I think they're ashamed of the little talent they have, and Drew and I being part of that. So, no, we don't, I'm not going. But, Drew, you're going to go?
I'm going to go.
Your wife's driving you nuts.
No,
she's listening. That's what that pause was.
No, I enjoy it.
She's driving you nuts.
No.
Okay.
I want to go too.
Good riddance. They can kiss my ass. Yeet is the love line.
Oh, my God.
I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew. John and Darren are both here from System of a Down. System of a Down is also the name of the CD that we're going to hear something on or off of, actually, after this next call. We're just talking to John about his 30,000 comics he has.
Wow.
That's a lot of... A lot of comics.
It's a lot of reading.
So you're going to the convention tomorrow.
Yeah, it's San Diego Comic Book Convention.
You're gonna buy some stuff?
I expect to.
What's the most you'll pay for something?
Depends on what it is. I paid a couple of grand for a book.
Really?
What was it?
It was a Batman 4.
How long ago did you buy it?
2 years ago.
You think it's worth more now?
I sold it already.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Did you make more?
Yeah. I used to sell comic books also. That was like what I did to make money.
Wow.
When we were struggling.
Yeah, I was just looking at some like sports memorabilia, jerseys and baseballs and stuff, and I just said to whoever's next to me, I'm so glad I'm not into that. Because otherwise I'd spend $3,500 on that baseball or something.
That's
I'd
me.
Go nuts.
Yeah.
I buy every jersey of every team in LA.
They're not cheap, man. It's like 200. I'm going to buy a Sparks jersey just because I haven't seen anybody wearing
Sparks jerseys.
That's right. And you're 28. What's up?
First, I wanted to tell you that in 1989, I was living in Santa Monica, and I was 17 and pregnant, and I was listening to your show, And something was very funny, and I thought I wet myself. And I actually went into labor while listening to your show.
Oh, my God. All right.
And I wanted to say that I gave the child up for adoption.
Oh, Anne, fantastic.
And I really wish that more girls that called you would seriously, seriously consider that as an option. Because
I wish we as a society would take people like you and give you medals and
I was just as screwed up and as irresponsible and flaky as every other 17-year-old girl. But
you had the wherewithal to make a choice that was on the best interest of the child.
I'm still waiting for her to yell a system of a down rules and hang up.
Hey, it's me. You know, remember us?
Do we know you?
I think that I'm too old because I used to think that I was so on the cutting edge of alternative music, and I've never even heard of the guys.
Oh, okay. How dare
it's
you?
All right.
I know.
We don't blame you.
All right. So do you have a question?
I do. I'm now 28, and I have a 3-year-old son who has an autistic spectrum disorder, and he is taking 3 different medications. He's very, very violent, and he's taking 3 different medications, and I'm wondering, is this a lifelong thing? I mean, is he going to be a violent teenager and adult, and does...
I know what autism is, but what's the spectrum part?
Well, it just means that they've widened the spectrum of different disorders. Yeah. That fit in that category.
They sort of have the sort of minimal brain syndromes. This sort of
He's pretty high functioning. Yeah. If you saw him, you might just think that he was very, very hyperactive and very poorly behaved.
And in fact, as kids get older, sometimes their actual diagnosis clarifies or presents itself.
Right.
So a child that might have been called autistic spectrum might have an entirely, it might be bipolar or ADD when they're 18.
Or sometimes it just gets downgraded to doofus, doesn't
it? But, and the point is that
does
change.
That's what happened to me, I remember.
It does change as they grow. And in my experience, and I'm certainly no expert in this area, it's difficult to predict what they're going to grow into.
Now, he's...
Hey, but, hey, Ann?
Yeah?
If he still is displaying violent tendencies by 13, you got to put him down.
Mm-mm.
For the good of society.
We have
you know what I'm saying.
And he... tries his best to terminate our little one-year-old.
What?
It's horrible. We have a one-year-old son also, and he does horrible things to him. He tries to gouge on his eyes.
Whoa.
Perfectly normal, perfectly healthy.
You're
going to have to teach that one-year-old to fend for himself.
Well, he's getting there. He's getting there. But
really?
I
was kidding.
To stay physically between them, you know, 24 hours a day.
Wow.
And my older son is taking clonidine, Risperdal, and Ritalin.
Is this the older?
That's a lot of medication for children.
This is the 3-year-old? I see. So you only have two boys?
Yeah, 2 little boys.
Oh, boy.
Are those medications, Drew, that are lifelong?
They will change.
They will change.
Yeah, they will change.
But he's
going to need medicine his whole life,
that's
for
pretty,
sure.
That's a pretty freaky situation that he's trying to attack your one-year-old.
It's horrible. It's horrible, you know, and I gave up this child 10 years ago for adoption. I thought, I'm doing the right thing. I'm going to wait till, you know, things are perfect, have a child, and I'll be a great parent. And now, you know,
my
situation, and it's just pretty disheartening. And the psychiatrists and millions of specialists don't want to give any, they won't tell me anything long term.
They can't. They can't.
What are they? They don't know.
These things are very hard to predict.
But those medicines will change.
Psychiatric medicines almost always change across a lifetime.
Do you have is there a man around there?
Yeah, I have a husband. We've been married for 5 years.
Good. You need a guy around there. Yeah, and you got to keep that one-year-old up on the top shelf so the 3-year-old doesn't get to him.
Yeah, it's scary. He stabbed me.
He's like Chucky, that kid of yours.
It's really scary.
That's what I'm picturing. Are you guys picturing Chucky?
Well, he's the sweetest little boy you've ever seen.
Oh, yeah, he sounds like it. Except when he's got a switchblade.
No, I was making dinner, and he's incredibly fast, and he...
With a knife?
Yeah.
Did he have any...
throwing knives.
Oh, my God. Really, you need a priest.
Anything happened to him in early in his infancy?
You need a priest.
Was he away from you for any long period of time or anything?
No, he came out of me screaming and never stopped, so I couldn't find a babysitter for him.
Does he have 666
in
the back of his
head? Why do you need a babysitter if you're with him all the time?
No, I mean, like, even to go on a date with my husband.
I see.
All right.
I would leave him with his grandparents, and, you know, they'd call me. He won't stop screaming. He won't stop screaming.
Oh, boy. All right. Hey, Anne, my heart goes out to you.
Sounds like the Omen from Damien.
Something that's unholy and evil.
You got your hands full, honey.
Thanks.
You need to call the Black Knight.
Chinagang Kabat.
Yeah.
If Drew had any idea about those medications. Cause
well, there, it's an interesting combination. It's a very aggressive combination for a three-year-old. Risperidol is a major tranquilizer.
Well, I guess they're trying to slow him down a little.
Yeah, Ritalin is for ADD, typically. And
get him a drum set.
Klonopin. And, get him the activities. And
I don't know much about rearing kids, but stabbing mom in the thigh, is that a timeout?
She's going to need a lot of aggressive behavior management. She's going to need pharmacotherapy, and it's going to be a lifelong proposition.
Buddy, and listen, I really mean this for society at large. You need to hobble that kid so he can't move so fast or something, because this kid's going to be 11. He's going to kill your kid. You know what I mean? I mean... I'm into this more into Darwinism than I am into human beings. I really am. I mean, I think if you got somebody and you know this person is violent and you know there's potential for trouble and it's almost just sort of a matter of time before something happens
to
him.
It's like a time bomb.
You can't let him out of the house. I mean, you can't let him in with the herd, so to speak. All right, Erica.
Hi.
Hey, you're 19.
Yeah. First of all, I just want to say, Adam, I am not obsessed with you, and I do not write your name on my shoes.
All right.
Careful, careful. Oh, I was afraid of that.
We got to move on. Ed?
Yeah, hi.
Ed, you're 15. What's up?
Yeah, I had a couple questions. The first one was for System of a Down. I'm a really big fan.
Thank you.
I might see you guys at the forum on the 29th.
The forum?
Yeah.
Which forum?
The Great Western Forum. 29th of September.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah.
I didn't know about that.
They're looking forward to the gig.
Well, they don't tell us these things yet.
Well, I wanted to know, what was your inspiration for Sugar?
Inspiration vocally or musically?
Vocally.
Vocally, I don't know.
No?
That's for you to figure out,
actually. Yeah, that's for you to figure out, because Sarah just comes up with stuff.
Yeah, I looked at the lyrics, and it was...
Yeah, we don't know either, man. In fact, neither does Serge.
Because it just sounds so good, and I didn't know what you guys were saying. And it was just...
Well, listen to it a couple more times.
We don't know either.
Dissect it in your head.
Yeah.
And see what
you can understand the words. It must be great. Yeah.
The thing is that everyone sees things differently.
Take some mushrooms and become the kombucha person.
Danny?
Yeah.
You're 14?
Yep.
What's up?
Nothing.
All right. Well, hold on
Wait.
No, let him hang on. I don't like these punk kids with their attitude.
Punk kids.
This is my people Sabbath tonight, you know. I shouldn't be here. Tyler?
Hey.
You're on with System of a Down, by the way.
Hi.
What's up?
First of all, Adam, Drew, you guys are awesome.
Great.
I had a couple questions for System of a Down.
Couple?
Yeah.
Okay,
bring it.
I was wondering if you guys are going to be on tour near San Francisco or anything.
I'm sure this tour comes there. I'm not sure what the dates are. Let's see if Adam has
it. Let me look.
Adam has the dates right in front of
him. This will not work if you're looking.
Yeah. I saw something that said...
We'll already be playing.
Go ahead. Ask the other question. I'll look it up.
The next question is...
Okay.
Oakland Arena, 9/28.
There it is.
Okay.
Okay. Also, I got the new City Toxicity.
Where'd you get it from?
Great. It's not on sale till September 4th.
Yeah, I know. I got it early.
Yeah.
It's awesome, though.
Thank you.
Christina. The song ATWA, how
do
you pronounce it?
Atwa,
yeah. How Darren's singing in the background with Serge, like, that's heck of cool. And I was wondering, how come he doesn't sing, much more than that?
He actually sings a lot on this album. He sings a lot more than he's done before.
Oh, really?
He sings
There's
on,
a lot of duets on
like
this
five,
album.
Six tracks, I think. Maybe more.
Oh, yeah?
More of those.
Okay. Yeah.
You all right there, Tyler?
Yeah, I'm cool.
All right, so they're coming on the 28th, did you say, Drew?
September 28th.
There you go. Let's pile ahead and talk to Ashley, 15.
Hello.
You ate the pot brownie?
Yes, I did.
And what's up?
Did you like it?
What?
Did you like it?
Yeah, it was good.
Yeah.
What's your question?
I wanted to know if, you could get sick after eating them.
Can you, vomit?
Yeah.
Some people do.
Yeah, for sure.
My friend ate them, and she
I have.
Totally chundered all over the place.
That really?
She chundered? Two wonderful new words tonight.
What you call in the medical dictionary is called lightweight.
Yeah.
Chunder. I'm looking up Chunder here in the dictionary.
All right.
It was the mad chronic though, so.
Okay, Chunder. So she couldn't handle it, but you could, right?
Yeah.
And that's all you need to know?
I also wanted to say...
Oh, but let me just jump in for 1 second, Ashley.
Okay.
If somebody eats a pot brownie and then heaves after they eat the pot brownie, You don't have to call up and ask the question, is it possible to throw up after eating a pot brownie?
No,
because
not what I wanted.
You're an expert. You were there.
I just wanted to know if you could get, like, something wrong with your stomach or
an allergy.
Just
no, you just vomited
out.
Out.
Like poison.
She won't be eating one again. That'll be it.
Yeah, system of a Down.
Yes.
I, like, totally love you so much. I can't even say. Like, my super inspiration. And you're awesome. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ashley.
Hell yeah.
Good times.
Good times.
Yeah. Let me say this. Let me kiss the band's ass for a second. tons of bands in here. Lots of big names, big bands all the time. Rarely get this kind of response and these kind of kudos for a band. Is that right, Drew?
Rarely.
Thank you, Drew.
I'm looking up a chunter here.
Drew, it's
right near chutzpah.
It's important for you just to repeat the last word I say when you're concentrating, all right?
Yeah, I did that, didn't I?
Yeah.
Sure.
Good.
That's right.
We rarely get this kind of response to a band. Isn't that right, Drew? Mm-hmm. Rarely.
Rarely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's the Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Wallace Langham's our guest tonight from Veronica's Closet, Tuesday nights, 9:30, NBC. Dave, you're 16.
Yeah?
What do you want?
I'm wondering if shrooms is better than doing acid.
Well,
probably, yeah.
It's like hitting yourself with a mallet as opposed to a frying pan over the head. But in my experience, acid does a lot more damage than mushroom. God, there's a great piece of data that came out on Ecstasy the other day that shows PET scannings of the serotonin receptors, serotonin pathways in the brain.
Right.
And it's just like shut down for years after ecstasy exposure, even modest ecstasy exposure.
Really?
Yeah. And so,
that leads to depression,
which is exactly what I'm seeing in clinic. I see it from acid even more so. And not so much with mushrooms, interestingly, and it's a weaker hallucinogenic, and people tend not to use much of
people
it.
People don't
it's
do
so,
it enough
so
to
awful.
Ever get any data on it.
Because you can't get them anywhere, man.
And it's awful, dude.
I can set you up, Wallace.
Awesome.
That's cool.
Is there, like, any brain damage that it can do or anything?
Yes. It appears that all the drugs that are primary hallucinogenics cause brain damage. And memory problems have been documented, and mood disturbances, panic, anxiety, those sorts of things, and they can be permanent.
Hey, Dave.
Yeah?
Hey, here's the catch-22. The people like yourself that are hell-bent on doing them are the people who should be doing them the least. You should be on a strict diet of exercise and carrot juice, and even then, you probably are not going to walk away with a 4-year degree in this lifetime. Now, your chances, which were slim, of being a success in this society will go to none, because you're hell-bent on screwing up your brain even more, and you didn't have that much to work with in the beginning. That is the sad irony of this situation. Dave, you should put a helmet on right now. You should get a special posturepedic mattress, and you shouldn't use your brain for anything other than important thinking.
Do you think you'd need one of those harnesses
to
be led around in?
Just the helmet.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, I know... And I know this sounds cruel, but I say a lot of these things. I know a lot of really intelligent people, and really intelligent people can beat themselves up a little and kind of get away with it.
Right.
Sometimes.
They can do blow for a few years. They can do booze for a while. They can get strung out on this or that. And then, lo and behold, they get off it, and they're kind of back.
Yeah, right.
You show me a guy who's a little marginal in the thinking department. Now you introduce a ton of weed and a ton of acid, and I'll show you guys, not even going to be able to work at the video store.
Yeah.
There he is.
It's true. I mean, I don't know. We never work it from this angle. But listen, a guy with 155 IQ, he can do a few
drugs.
Maybe.
He can pull it off. Maybe.
No, I know these guys. They'll lower themselves down to 135 and still beat you out for the job.
Yeah, yeah.
But when you're hovering in the mid-80s, low 90s, and you start toking out every day, now you're screwed.
Do you like fries with that?
There you go. David?
Yeah?
You're 13?
12?
Yeah.
Wow.
All right. Cool. What's up there, Buckaroo?
I gave my little brother Viagra when they switched it with my Adderall.
What? Perfectly normal, perfectly healthy.
Wait a minute.
Who? Somebody gave you Viagra?
No. I have ADD. And the
I understand.
Shop thing over by my house, they like... It was, they gave me the wrong bottle.
They gave you Viagra instead of your Adderall.
And it didn't say my name on it or anything.
And do you normally give your medications to your little brother?
No.
Why did you give this one to him?
Because he was, like, chasing, me around. I said, hey, dude, this isn't mine. And so he, like, chased me around, and he was getting really annoying. And so I threw it at him, and he, like, managed to get the top thingy off. And
how old is he?
He's 5.
Whoa.
When did this happen?
Like, I don't know, like, on Friday, I think.
Did you tell your parents about this?
No, I...
Why not?
What am I supposed to say?
There was an accident,
my
and your
Viagra.
Yeah, but
well, the bottle that you shouldn't have had in the first place. He got his hands on and got it took.
Wait a minute. How do you know it was Viagra?
Because it said Viagra and some other guy's name on it.
And why didn't at the time? When did you discover that it wasn't yours?
Like when I got home.
Okay, why didn't you give it to your parents at that point?
Because. I don't know.
He's a demon, this kid.
Dude.
So, what happened to your brother?
Humped
the bejesus out of the dog?
I don't know. No. He had a sleepover, and that's what freaked me out.
Oh, wait a minute now. This just keeps getting thicker. The 5-year-old hopped up on Viagra has a slumber party?
No, he goes to one, except that, like, I tried to get him into trouble so he wouldn't go, but it didn't work.
All right, so he went to a sleepover.
Yeah, and I want to know, like, what he's going to do.
Well, wait a minute. Have you talked to him since Friday?
No, it was at his friend's house who, like, moved away.
How did he seem for the couple hours after
he went out? He went out of state for a sleepover?
Yeah.
For the couple hours afterward, I didn't see him because he went to bed at, like, 8, and it was...
And when was
this? I don't know, actually.
Do you still have this medication on you?
Do I have it, like, with me now?
Yeah.
I threw it all away.
Okay.
And
next time you send it to Uncle Adam and care of the radio station.
I'm confused. He went to
hold
bed,
on a
and
second.
Then he went to a slumber party?
Hold on a second. This kid is 13. Yeah. 13's young,
yeah.
But it ain't that young.
Yeah.
I mean, when we were 13, were you in the 8th grade?
Yeah. Yeah.
You show up, you do your homework, you converse with other kids, yeah. You ask girls out on dates. Yeah. I mean, you have wood shop. You're not like, and then Barney gave me something shiny, and I mean.
But there's such a thing as that at 13.
Oh, there is. You don't have to tell me, but yeah. Hold on. Let me talk to this lad. I have a quick man-to-man with him. Hey, David?
Yeah?
Why, wake up. You're 13 years old. In the Jewish religion, you're a man, technically, right now.
Whoa.
You understand?
Yeah.
You're lucky you're not a Jew. They toss you right out. Now, listen to me. Listen to me.
Okay.
You got the Viagra. I understand that. You gave it to your little brother, who's 5. He took the pill. He took it. Shut up. Shut up. Listen to me. He took it that night?
Yeah, he took one of them.
He took one of them that night. Then what? Did he go to bed at home that night?
Yeah.
Yes, he went to bed at home.
But he wasn't there when I woke up.
He went to bed at home.
Yes.
And you went to bed at home.
Yes.
But you didn't see him the next morning.
No, because he left early.
Because he left early to go on a sleepover.
Yeah,
because... All right. And he got in the car and drove with your parents. Actually, not your parents, but just your mom. Your parents are divorced. To this sleepover the following morning.
Yeah, with
okay.
Other kids.
Okay. All right, with other kids. Fine.
Not a problem. It's out of the system very shortly.
There you go.
But I know of no cases of young people taking this. I'm sure there have been incidental exposures because enough of that medicine is out there, and I've not seen any data of any serious complications from that. But you need to tell your parents about it.
Let me tell you what this, David. I was this close to taking my belt off. Actually, I don't have a belt. I just have a drawstring because I wear sweatpants.
That would have done enough damage. I'm looking at the drawstring.
That's what I'm going to threaten my kid with. Don't make me pull this drawstring out and do the cats in the cradle thing.
Here's the awful thing about that age of that 12.
15. Oh, Jacob's ladder, your ass.
Yeah.
You guys, that 12, 13, 14 age group, some of our callers who are 13 sound like David.
Yeah.
Some sound like Barry White.
Right. Yes.
It's
right.
Just, it's an awful age.
Yeah. It's great because, later on tonight, we'll talk to a 13-year-old that's like, I was fingering this bitch in my brother's van.
My dad walked in.
We just put back a couple of highballs, and I had some reefer, and my dad come in. He wasn't pissed, but he wanted in, you know.
We wrestled for him and kicked his ass.
So I beat him with a tire iron, and we got done fingering this bitch. And then, yeah, I mean, we'll talk to them tonight. It is a love line. I'm Adam. That is Dr. Drew over there. Jeremy McGrath, the Elvis of Supercross, is here in the building tonight. Saturday is the fifth race. He's all locked up, and he's got two wins, and what's-his-nose has two wins, and now... Now we're going to see who's on top after this Saturday, and it is huge. And get those tickets, and you know what? Screw you. Don't get them. They're still going to sell out.
Suzanne?
Hello?
You're 15.
Yeah, Adam, I lied about my question. I just wanted to say how much I love you. You're my God. I worship you.
Okay, really?
I swear to God. Oh, my God. I know.
Hey, Adam.
My friend.
There's one of those girls.
Wow, this is great.
Oh, my God. Adam, I love you. I'm so sorry.
Hey, put this on a cart. Would you understand it? I'll listen to it. Put on a loop.
Put it on the cassette. You can listen to the way home.
Yeah.
My friend Ben is over here also. And we were just on the internet right now downloading pictures of you.
Oh,
and we have a bunch of pictures of you and Dr. Drew.
Can't imagine.
And oh my God, Adam, we have you on our notebooks, like those two 12-year-old little girls.
Oh, I love that.
Adam, we
that
were outraged
I love.
That they called in.
Yeah.
We were just outraged at those. Outraged. We were completely outraged that those two little girls called in because we love you so much.
We don't remember them, Suzanne.
No, I do. How dare you? I remember them quite well.
Yeah, and we say all these things that you say. Like we always say, "How dare you?" Now.
Oh.
And I'm outraged. Oh my God, Adam, you have no idea.
Wow. Like,
why don't you start using some more appropriate? Start using the Queen's English, Adam.
No.
So at least you have some sort
I don't
of.
Know it. Hey, Suzanne. What? How am I on your notebook?
Pictures of you from the internet, and they're colored and stuff, and we put you on our binder, and, your name is written all over my shoes.
Oh my shoes. God, you know you've arrived when you're on the peachy
sweater
and the shoes.
You are it.
Because when I was in junior high, it was Aerosmith and Led Zeppelin, and I said, one day I'm going to be on some chick's Vans, and now that day has come. Well, that's it. I'm retiring. My work is
put
done.
Put in your 2 week, man.
Oh, that is great. I love that. And speaking of Vans, Jeremy, what do you got going with Vans?
This year I signed a new deal with Vans, and we're coming out with a shoe, and you know, Jeremy McGrath's shoe, which is going to be out in August, I think,
and
it's just a new signature shoe.
Jeez, Vans is one of those companies that has just been there
for
a million years.
Yeah.
I'm guessing they started out here.
1966.
I'm sure. Yeah.
And I remember the Vans. I mean, I remember it out in North Hollywood and everyone buying a red one and a blue one and then getting custom ones made. And they've just hung in there for a million years. Shannon?
Hi.
You're 23. What's up?
I'm sorry. I'm kind of nervous.
That's all right.
But when I was younger, I would have thoughts of there would be an old woman walking down the street, and I would just have the thought of pushing her. It wouldn't be an urge or anything, but it would just be a thought. And this was when I was six, seven. It was just kind of funny. And you know, little things would happen at school, like I would have an urge. It wouldn't be an urge, like I said, but the thought of going up and kissing my teacher or something. And then I'm 23 now, married and have a little baby. Now I'm having just the thoughts of smothering my baby. I mean, there's no fear at all that I would actually do it.
Right.
But it's still, you know, disturbing just the same to have them.
Do you have any other sorts of compulsive behaviors?
No, not that I know of.
You don't do any rituals? You don't are afraid to step on cracks in the sidewalk or wash your hands excessively?
No.
But isn't it... I mean, actually, I used to remember having thoughts like jumping off of buildings when you were looking over the edge and stuff.
Yeah, it would be like that.
Yeah.
Now I'm too lazy,
You know, with the baby, I mean, I would be sleeping next to my husband, and I would have a thought of stabbing him, you know, and I, I wouldn't do it.
But these are
right.
sort of...
I mean, you have to, beer and a half for you to do something like that.
And you have no history of violence.
No.
These are sort of intrusive thoughts, and usually, you know, one of the things that can cause intrusive thought process would be obsessive compulsive disorder. There's also high levels of anxiety sometimes do this. You ever have panic attacks?
Yes.
Yeah, panic and anxiety. Sometimes people get weird thoughts.
You ever go to a funeral or a wedding and think about just freaking out in the middle of the quietest part of the ceremony?
I do
too. I always think about that.
Those are always the situations you go what if I did this and what if I did that?
Do you get panic?
Those are fine. I can deal with those. Those are, funny.
Do you get high levels of anxiety in response to these thoughts?
I'm sorry?
Do the thoughts trigger panic or high anxiety?
No.
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 All right. Well, how I mean, you say there's no way you would act on this.
No.
So how you're not fearful of them, then, are you?
No.
I mean, what I mean is if you have these thoughts, you're not happy about the thoughts, but if there's no way in the world you're going to act on them, then it's not, you know, it's not like we're in a real crisis area here.
It happens all the time.
You know, do you have any other less disturbing intrusive thoughts? Things that are just sort of more random?
Mm-hmm.
Like what?
Just, like, pushing old ladies. And
no, I mean, not aggressive thoughts. Do you have any just
aggressive?
Sort of... Yeah.
None that really come to mind.
Okay.
All right. What do you do for a living, just for fun?
I'm a housewife.
Oh, okay. It'd be funny if you work with kids or the elderly or something like that. You know, it's always very ironic. Well, listen, Shannon, were you ever any trauma in your life? Any reason that you should have these thoughts?
I had them, no trauma when I was younger, before I had started having the thoughts.
Trauma since you started having the thoughts?
Yes.
What's happened?
Well, I dabbled into drugs when I was about 12. I started and got into it quite heavily and got sent away for 18 months.
Oh, really?
So I did, you know, the whole therapy process. So, I mean, I'm familiar with it.
What was the drug?
Heroin.
All right. So there's a lot more going on here, Shannon.
But this is all, I mean, I'm 23 now. I mean, I haven't touched any drugs since I was 16.
All right. Well, maybe it's time to get back in a little, adult therapy.
Yeah. Yeah. This might be sort of forming into more specific...
So you think this is something that... Because my husband and I, were doing the marriage counseling. I mean, should this be something that should be brought up in
the counseling? Oh, absolutely.
Or more at home?
No, bring it up in the counseling.
Because I'm afraid, I mean, if I tell him, especially, you know, with her daughter...
No, you've been
I've had thoughts of killing her.
Yeah, but you've been very clear that these are pure abstract thoughts with no even potential of behavior attached to them.
Still, if you're sitting in the office and she's saying, sometimes when he's asleep, I think about just taking a sprinkler key and going right into the small of his back watching him bleed to death.
But it's
that's got to be a little rough while you're sitting there and you're like your beef with her is like sometimes dinner's not warm when you come home, like when you work late, and she's talking about putting a hatchet in your head.
But it's pure thought, not plan.
No, I know, but still, it's got to be just a little disconcerting.
Now, why would you think she would be thinking those thoughts? Just anxiety, you say, or something?
No, there's some more substantial global psychiatric syndrome here, and she needs diagnosing is what she needs. And I'm sure there's treatments for this.
But is there, I know this isn't what it is, but a sort of Tourette's of the mind?
That's a nice way of thinking of it. I mean, that's exactly the same kind of phenomenon we're talking about here.
Where it's just these negative flashes just kick in constantly. Yeah. It's like...
And you want to control them. They don't mean anything, but they mean something more globally, but in and of themselves don't mean something.
All right. We will take ourselves a little break. Back in a minute.
I thought that was real.
What was that?
David Alan Greer. Let me do what we call on radio reset in the show. David Alan Greer is our guest tonight. He's promoting an upcoming role.
No, stop right there, mister.
He's here.
What I'm
sharing
promoting
the love.
Is human kindness.
That's right.
I'm trying to heal these babies.
While he's here, I am promoting Three Strikes, which is out in theaters on March 1st.
Directed by the great DJ Pooh.
And he wrote it too, right?
Yes, that's right. He co-wrote Fridays.
Also, he'll be in Return to Me with Minnie Driver and David Duchovny, which is coming out April 7th.
Yeah.
And an NBC show called DAG.
Dagaroni, baby!
That's an acronym for David Alan Greer.
There you go.
Beautiful. Sarah? Love what's up? You're 14, Sarah.
Yeah. My boyfriend, when he broke up with me, he said it was because I was, too overweight. But it's, I'm 5'3", and I weigh 120. Mm-hmm. And my bra size is C38, so I didn't think I was that overweight, but then he kept, telling me that I was. Mm. So I went on, a starve diet, and when I'd eat, I'd throw up, and now, when I throw up, I have a lot of blood.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And bleeding when you vomit is a medical emergency.
That's bad news.
Yeah, it's probably from a tear in your esophagus, and you can bleed to death in a few minutes with that. So if that happens, you have to go to the emergency room.
Really?
Yeah. How long have you been throwing up?
Just 2 weeks.
Oh, all right. And you doing it every day?
Every other day or any time I eat, and I haven't been eating too much.
All right.
You must stop. This is a
what is your weight? Do you know what your weight is right now?
Like 115, 120.
And what is up with your boyfriend that he said, I'm breaking up with you because you're fat?
Well, he didn't say it straight out. Hated him so much, like, after, because he was really sincere at first, and then after that, yeah. It was like, when he broke up with me, he told my best friend, he's like, oh, don't tell her this, but, you know, I broke up with her because she was overweight, and, like, you know, I'm really in love with you. And
asshole.
So hold on. You hate him so much that now you're starving yourself and puking?
No, I mean, it's like, you know, I was like, okay, I had something really good with him, and it's like, if it was so bad that something that good could, like, be over because of that. It was like, I didn't want it to happen again.
Right. Dr. Drew, I can't.
Yeah. Hey, Sarah.
Uh-huh.
You got to get yourself checked out because blood came out when you vomited. All right?
All right.
And number two, you got to stop doing this. And number three, you have to sort of get your life in order a little bit.
Well, it's not really that bad. It just
There's something going on. A guy broke up with you, told your best friend you're chubby, and now you're spinning out of control. I mean, something's. You're not on solid ground here. Something's up.
Well, it's not like really bad. It's like you probably think it is, but it's not. Like,
Sarah,
awful.
You've had a life-threatening complication already.
Yeah.
Okay, that's bad enough. Okay.
All right. So what? Go to the hospital.
Yeah.
You got to get checked out.
Plus, she's going to have electrolyte problems, could get heart problems, kidney problems from this.
Guys, can we deal with my medical problems? Dr. Drew, I think I'm coming down with the flu. Now, I saw on TV that little thing that you spray in your
Relenza.
Mouth.
It's great.
Hey, does that really work?
Oh, it's awesome.
Oh, can you kick me down a prescription? Because it just started today.
Why do you
It's not addictive. Am I going to get high off of it?
Why do you need a prescription for that?
It's antiviral medicine.
Come on.
What's wrong with it?
Give me a prescription, please. And while you're at it, give me some Dilaudid.
Yeah,
please. Dr. Drew, come on. I need it. Come on. Give me the flu stuff.
Drew, why stuff for flu, though? I mean, why is that a prescription? Because it's powerful? Because what? What's the danger?
Interaction with other medications.
I'm not on any medication.
They actually started having some problems with it this year. It created problems with people with asthma and lung disease.
I don't have any of that. Please, may I have the prescription?
You got something in your trunk, a sample or something, don't you, Drew?
Come on, Dr. Drew, come over. Hey, man, you are so...
Yeah, he's tight. Kelly?
Yes?
You're 29.
Yes.
Thank God, an adult. Kelly, talk to me, baby. What's going on with you?
What is that?
Okay, I've been writing this guy for 2 years. In the last year, we kind of started falling in love.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to know if it's possible to fall in love with somebody that you've never met, but you talk to him on the phone and through letters.
It is in the movies, but not in real life.
No, that's not true. That's not true. But why haven't you seen him? Why haven't you met him?
Only if you're real desperate.
He's in jail. Is he in jail?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, why are you gonna fall in love with somebody in jail?
I don't know.
Yeah, you do know.
I have no idea. He's just a really sweet guy.
What's he in jail for?
He took a rap for somebody else.
Oh, of course. What's the rap to the person?
Theft.
Right.
Theft and with a weapon?
No.
And why did he do that?
Because he don't rat on people.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, he's a good guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you ever dated a man who's been in prison before?
My ex-husband was.
Exactly. Well, you know, that's fine
and
for
And, of
you.
Course, he took a rap for somebody else, too, right?
Well, no. I mean, I was married to my ex-husband 9 years.
But he wasn't at fault for what he got put in jail for.
No.
Yeah, of course not.
Yeah.
No.
Hey, well, she's doing fine, I'd say.
Oh, Kelly.
Hey, Kelly.
What?
First off, I can hear it in your voice. You're broken.
Yeah.
I mean, you've had a tough life, right?
Oh, yeah.
You've been 29.
Kicked around a little bit. Sounds like you swallowed a trash can lid. You know what I mean?
I prefer to call Kelly's voice smoky and sexy. Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
Gravelly and cancery is the way I would describe
Kelly, what's the kind of guy that you just don't go for? A guy with a good job, never been to prison, probably just wants to love you for who and what you are, and straight as an arrow. You wouldn't go for a guy like that?
Well, yeah, I would. But I'm not saying this guy, you know, is bad either.
All right. Wait, Kelly?
What?
Why is this guy in prison?
He told me he was in there for theft for somebody else.
Right. What did he steal? What did the other person steal?
Drugs, I think.
Stole some drugs.
Magic.
Right. And, how did you meet the guy?
Through a friend that knew him.
And so your ex-husband was an addict also?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. So you got to have an addict. You got another addict on your hands.
There you go. At least this one's locked up where he can't get to you. When's he getting out?
I don't know. He keeps on screwing up and going back.
Oh, yeah. That's great. I say get married to him now. I thought he took a rap for somebody else.
Well, the other guy comes in, beats on one of the guards, and then sneaks back out.
And then puts cocaine in his pockets.
And he gets a rap for it.
Let me ask the other question. How many kids you got, Kelly?
I say three.
One?
Okay. Here's what I would suggest.
You put
I would
that
say,
kid
get
in a basket
conjugal.
And put it down the river. It would be raised by baboons. It'd have a better chance.
I believe in love, Kelly. I say get a conjugal visit.
No.
And immediately get impregnated by this man. And marry him, and you'll live happily ever after.
Kelly?
Call me nuts. Call me crazy.
Kelly, listen to me. How old's that kid of yours?
David, you're nuts.
Okay.
She's 7 years old.
7 years old. All right. She has three possible employment opportunities right now. Stripper, crack whore, welfare mom. Now, you can start doing your job, raising her, stop obsessing about guys in prison, and start focusing on your goddamn kid. Would you please?
And this guy
and get
undoubtedly.
Off the drugs and start being mommy. Be alone for a little while.
My life revolves around my daughter. Revolves around my daughter.
Good. And listen, if your life revolved around your daughter, you wouldn't be thinking about hooking up with a guy who's in the joint.
An addict.
Who's going to come out and do something weird to your daughter.
Absolutely.
All right, mommy?
Okay.
All right. Jim.
Yeah.
You're 17.
Yeah.
What's up?
First, I want to say what's up to Van A's.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I have an ex-girlfriend.
Yeah.
And she's stalking me.
Right.
It's like she would like drive up in front of my house and like call me on her cell phone and stuff. Uh-huh.
How many times a day does she call?
Like two.
Why do you take her calls?
No, wait a minute. Two like, times a day, that ain't stalking, man. Come on.
Like she would like drive in front of my house and like call me up from the cell phone and like say that she's there and then just like drive off.
Okay.
Can you avoid her calls somehow? Change your phone number?
I'm not really.
Hey, listen, Jim, you got to be able to get rid of a girl.
Yeah, I mean.
Can't figure that out?
You know what, guys? I think I need to talk to both of you knuckleheads.
What's that?
You know, when I first came to this place, this was a sacred place, you were energized, you were excited by talking to these sick, deranged young people. Mm-hmm. Now I see Dr. Drew's rubbing his head. You're picking your nose, you know, telling people, shut up. Oh, get rid of your disease, your knuckleheaded ex-wife.
Right.
Guys, let's focus in.
You're right.
Let's try and give these young people some love and some caring the way you used to do 4 or 5 years ago when you weren't big shots with your books and your man show and your computer talk thing.
That's Dave, my main mayonnaise.
That's right.
Before it became mayonnaise. All right, David is right. Drew, I'm willing to recommit to the show for the next 10
it.
Minutes. What about you?
Hands together, man. Come on.
Hand
man. Hands
man.
Together, baby.
And
all right.
Go.
Oh, man.
All right.
I am healing the babies tonight.
I'm going to talk to Marvin over here.
I want to talk to Marvin. That's the new Adam.
I want to talk to Marvin. Marvin?
Did Dad finally get you to take therapy? Yes, is that what happened, David?
I've been in therapy.
I can tell.
This is Adam. How can I help you, buddy?
Yeah, my hair is, I got hair kind of like Adam. It's part nappy, part wavy hair.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Hey, how you doing? Ooh, look at your hair.
And you get the neck rash, do you?
Yeah.
And you shave.
Really bad shaving bumps. And
right.
The only problem is that I'm brown, I'm African-American, and I'm like probably light brown.
I know. Skin. I'm the only white guy on the planet who gets a neck
well,
rash.
Well, you better stop right there. Maybe you're not all white, Adam.
Somebody could have jumped the fence, brother.
Yeah, of course.
Somebody could have jumped that back fence.
The penis is all white. Well, I don't know. There could have been a prison
look
break.
Adam,
you're right.
I'm your daddy.
Well, listen, a black guy gets a neck rash, it's no problem. But he don't have the pink skin like I have. It doesn't show up on him.
Just looks a little darker.
Well, the thing is, it looks really bad on me because I'm light brown.
Okay.
You got to right. get the laser.
No.
You got to you get laser or the funky face or get you a real cool girlfriend to pick your ingrowns, homie.
Why can't you get the laser?
Because it'll show discoloration.
Yeah, you can't do it on the black guys. It makes them white.
Yeah, but you know what? You got to find the right doctor because I have a dermatologist here in town. They specialize in ethnic skin. That's not only African Americans, Mediterranean, Hispanic, Asian
skin people.
Yeah, and scarring. They can really hook you up. It's going to cost you thousands of dollars, brother. So you might want to, you know.
No, David, you get that neck rash?
I don't.
Why not?
Well, among other blessings,
God has chosen not to give me that, Adam.
Son of a bitch. I'm a white guy.
No, sometimes I get one rash. Or two, but I don't get, like, a lot of them. You know?
All right.
Like,
Marvin?
Yeah.
I have done extensive experimentation in this department, and I'm going to tell you how to correct this problem.
Thank you, my brother.
Thank you. Here's how it works. First off,
benzoyl peroxide.
Hold on. Drew, you shut up. Okay. Drew's got to jump in, doesn't he?
Excuse me?
He's got to play doctor. Okay. Hey, brother, I'm here to help tonight.
There you go.
Marvin?
Yeah.
Forget all that over-the-counter junk they talk about bump away and bump off and bump yourself and all that other stuff. No, that's no good.
Right.
Here's the way to get rid of the neck rash. Now, you're never going to get rid of it. You're just going to control it.
Okay.
And I'm going to tell you how
Hold on.
Do that.
Let me just jump in for real quick.
Yeah.
What do you shave with?
Gillette sensor.
No, you can't do that. You cannot shave with that. Here's what I shave with. I shave with an electric shaver.
Ooh, no.
No, but listen to me. Hold on, brother. Hold on. What it is a clipper that's used to, like, to edge your, like, neckline. What it does is it doesn't take the hair follicle all the way down to the skin. You're not going to get as close a shave, but you want to keep that hair follicle
just... How many times
a
day do you shave?
I can shave twice a day.
Yeah.
But it doesn't bring the hair follicle down so you get an ingrown hair. That's what you need.
Yeah.
Look at this. Smooth and lovely. The ladies love it, brother. That's right. You got to go to the store and get this little
like they use on a dog.
It's fairly
solid. No, like they use on a human being, my racist friend.
Yes.
All right, Drew, that's why I won't do your little internet show.
You're calling black men dogs,
it's true. Adam has a TV show, and now you're race baiting.
They're dog clippers.
All right, Marvin.
They're not. They're for human beings, Dr. Know-It-All.
You guys give me 45 seconds alone with Brother Marvin over here. Marvin?
Tornado.
Listen, David is right, and I will give you a technique as well. He is right. You don't want to shave against the grain.
Right.
A number one. Now, here's a problem. Your hair grows in many different directions. You have to find out which direction is where. It may grow one direction on your cheek and one direction on your neck.
Okay.
It grows a little different direction around your Adam's apple, and that's why everyone gets that along the neck. You must shift the razor and go the direction that the hair is growing.
Okay.
That is A number one. B number two, before you shave, and even once a day, you got to get yourself some of that crushed up pumice scrub stuff, that apricot seed stuff.
Oh.
Put it on a wash rag and scrub that neck. You scrub off all the dead skin cells, and the hair gets freed up. It doesn't get buried under there. It doesn't grow in. And here's the last thing. Shave before you go to bed at night, and then take a nice big dollop of Oxy-10 and just cake it on that area. It dries it up. It doesn't let it get all weird and infected. I don't know why this worked. No one told me about it. I just stumbled onto it myself. Just take a nice big blob of that zit cream, benzoyl peroxide, and just rub it in that area and go to bed at night with that crap on there. I'm telling you, it'll decrease it markedly.
Do you do that every day?
I don't shave every day, but when I do, I always do. Yeah.
That's another thing. Don't shave every day.
Okay.
Shave every other day. All right, Marvin, call us back. Tell me how it went.
Cool, man. Thanks.
Wait a minute. If it doesn't go well, don't call back.
Oh, I will.
All right. Thanks, Marvin.
Nuts.
Steve?
Hi.
You're 19. What's up?
Hi. My question is primarily for Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
a few nights ago, some friends of mine and I intentionally overdosed on a cough and cold medicine called Coricidin.
Intentionally meaning trying to harm yourself?
No. Intentionally because it contains dextromethorphan.
Yeah, why'd you pick Coricidin of all things? I mean, there's a bunch of other stuff in there, too.
Did this suddenly turn into Mr. Wizard, Adam?
Yeah.
Steve, what's the question? It's a cold medicine, basically.
No, over-the-counter cold medicine. Stuff? That's that orange stuff, right?
So he just drank a bunch of it, and Coricidin is the altered, like, narcotic.
Are you talking about Coricidin tablets?
Coricidin tablets, cough and cold.
So what's the question?
Well, I've experimented with some dextromethorphan use before, and I had heard from several people that Coricidin was a different, more intense trip.
Well, it's got Sudafed in it, certainly the Coricidin D does, and it's also got chlorpheniramine, which is an antihistamine. So you're going
to... Chlorpheniramine is what I was concerned about, and that's what my question pertains to.
Yeah.
I had read some about the effects of the antihistamine. And
you can get a delirium from that, and then once you've survived it, you're fine. And the Sudafed can raise your blood pressure and cause strokes and heart attacks.
What
but
about
again,
the kidneys?
Once you've survived it, you're okay. The dextromethorphan, the sort of jury is out. It's being called robo-tripping or DXM, and they're actually selling it as ecstasy because it has a similar kind of an experience associated with it. It's a hallucinatory. And hallucinogens seem to carry the capacity of some degree of brain damage.
But how much do they take?
How many did you take, Steve?
I took 13.
That's a lot.
That's nice.
Why 13?
Well, that was what I read was a fair dosage for a third plateau trip.
And what?
You're wrong. You took 13 because 1 + 3 = 4. 4 in the whole scheme of things. We're in a 4-year. Mm-hmm. A 4 is a challenge number. When you take 4, you're saying, "Hey, I'm going to meet what I fear the most." So this is like he took his future to burst on through and see like what where he's going. That's why he took 13.
Well, could
speaking
be
of stroke,
too. Yeah. Hey, Steve. Did you get off? Did you hallucinate?
Steve?
Actually, the experience was pretty dysphoric, and I slept for months.
Oh, yeah.
Dysphoric.
Listen, why don't you just break down and get some mushrooms?
Yeah,
huh?
You know what I'm saying? What is up,
or some antidepressant.
You know what I do? I slam my head in the door like 3 times. Mm-hmm. Boom, nice.
Nice.
Yeah,
nice.
That would be a little less damaging.
David, what do you like? What do you like? A little nip once in a while? A little booze?
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, Adam. I'm back in the Vikes, Dr.
Ah, I
Drew.
See. Old Vicodin.
The old Vickety Vikes there. I'm doing a movie in Mexico, and so you know where I'm going. I'm stubbing my toe the first night out. Por favor, doctor, tú tienes de
laudid? You don't have to call the doctor for that. You go right down to the pharmacy and just pick it up. Right?
Well, let me ask you something. I read an article about Vicodin. And they were saying, like, usually guys that get addicted to it, it's not the Vicodin, it's the acetaminophen or something that rips up your liver.
Well, that's
because you're taking, like, 50
No, no, no. Well, you're addicted to the opiate, which is the hydrocodone. Right. And the acetaminophen is what can hurt you in the product. And
yeah, but I'm just saying, what if you're a little older, gentlemen?
Here's what's
you hang out with the young
here's
girls,
what's
you pop a few Vicks every week or so.
If you took, if I give you 13 Vicodin now,
I'd be dead.
You'd be dead in 2 days. Right. But
really?
Something about
let's do it.
But something about the way people escalate their use of Vicodin when they're addicts seems to give the liver enough time to adjust to develop the enzymatic machinery to handle the Tylenol so there's no more toxicity.
Well,
my average Vicodin addict is taking 50 Vicodin a day.
Wow.
And I've treated many have taken 100 to 120 a day. No liver problem.
Where do you get your hands on 50 Vicodin a day?
That's a lot.
They usually end up ripping off prescription pads.
Well, you know what Judy
going to multiple
Judy,
pharmacies.
The late, great Judy Garland had minions who would go and fill her prescriptions. She'd go through 2 boxes.
Back then, I'm sure it was no problem.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
And you know the incredible thing about
Elvis
her. She died when she was 13
really.
Years old. Sang her heart out.
Oh, yeah. She was a trooper in a town.
The man that won me has come out and undone me. Ah, oh, Judy.
I think Elvis kind of ruined it for all us guys who knew doctors and thought we could get a little candy on the side.
Let me ask you something, Dr. Drew. Why do all these pill-popping knuckleheads always die on the toilet? What's going on there?
Yeah, what's up with that?
Judy Garland and Elvis Presley both died.
On the toilet.
Constipated on the toilet.
That's not been my experience, but you're taking 50 Vicodin a day. You're spending a little bit of time working on the toilet.
Oh, really?
No, constipated?
Very constipated.
Are you talking about the little rabbit pellets that's like giving
birth? If you're lucky.
Comes out like shotgun pellets.
I know.
Bowling ball.
No!
Well, that makes sense. You take a bunch of Vicodin, you're constipated, you spend half the day on the toilet, you're pushing hard, and you get a hemorrhage, right? You get an aneurysm.
My experience, my addicts don't die on the toilet.
No, they die when Drew hits them with the bill.
Oh, no. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Adam Carolla. He's going to be doing 2 shows nightly here at Dingleberry's. Love to love you, Adam. Very good.
Loving you, Dave. Thanks. Next up, very funny man. Very friend of mine. You know him from In Living Color, Mikkel's Navy. Give it up for my main man, David Allen Greer.
Cut the music. Cut the music. Smile up in his bush. Is in the White House. I'd like to get in some bush. But seriously, though, you know what?
Yeah.
Ah, that's my time. 1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
Let's take a ride. Yeah. It is Loveline. I'm Adam. That is true. Take a ride back to the phones here. Jose?
Yes.
You're 19.
Huh? Yes.
Yes. Oh, boy. Wait, let's listen. Let's listen for our voice.
Here it comes. I knew we were coming sooner or later. Hold on, Jose, don't do anything. Let's try it again. All right, we'll say howdy on the count of three. Ready?
All right.
One, two, three. Howdy.
Howdy. Howdy. How you doing?
Hold on, Jose, don't do anything.
How you guys doing over there?
Shh. This is fun. I want to leave myself a reminder. Adam, don't forget wallet and keys from studio.
This is fun. I want to leave myself a reminder. Adam, don't forget wallet and keys from studio.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I get my keys and my wallet. All right, hold on, Jose. Hold on, wait. It's a delay. Watch this. Jose, turn your radio down. No, I put him on hold.
There you go. He'll
so get, we'll check the, back with him.
When in, he gets the message, yeah.
He'll get the message in, what is it, about seven, 8 seconds?
Yeah. Let's go on to the next call in the meantime.
Well, I bet he has it by now. How many seconds?
He has it.
Oh, there. We got it.
Four.
Jose?
Yes.
Okay, the radio down?
Yes.
Nice. What's going on, brother?
Well, I met this 19-year-old girl, and I don't want to be with her. I've told her time and time again, I don't like her. I don't want to be with her. I have nothing to say to her. Mm-hmm. She still keeps bugging and bugging and bugging.
Man, you're too good to lay. You're too good looking. You're too well hung.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, and he's still got the radio up. Oh. And you're
smart.
And you're partially retarded. Maybe she's a social worker or something. Is she trying to get you to put a hockey helmet on, or does she keep calling you because she wants dates?
She wants dates, and I don't want to go out with her.
All right. Well, that's rough. There's nothing you can do, though. There's really nothing. You have to date her. There's nothing. What do you do, Drew? She keeps calling.
Joe? Joe?
Hello?
Yep.
Hi.
What's going on there?
Everybody's even facing fake names tonight.
Yeah, everyone's having difficulty processing their fake name.
Everybody's on hold. Write down your fake name so when we
please
come on and ask, you know, say that's, hello with that name.
That's what that long pause is when we keep asking the person's name. Go ahead, Joe.
All right. I have a couple questions about LSD. First of all, do you know what, like, to say the statistics are of people going completely crazy after using LSD?
A single episode? A single use?
I'm thinking more of, like, well, I don't know about single use, but, like...
So here's the deal. All right, here's the deal. Single use, a permanent psychosis after a single use would be very rare.
Okay.
A locked-in syndrome after regular heavy use or even one large ingestion is very common, where people feel kind of persistently high and kind of locked into a dream for weeks or even months afterwards. Those people will all have chronic mood problems. And my experience has been that anybody that does acid more than about 30, 40 times is going to have problems with persistent depression the rest of their life that may not become evident for at least 5 to 10 years after you stop using.
Okay. I don't know, because...
And even in the literature in the 70s, it was there to defend the use of LSD. It's bizarre to read that literature now, because in the literature they conclude that people end up with personality changes and mood disturbances, but that they seem happier, therefore it's okay.
And back then it was good. Yeah, it's like, hey...
It's bizarre.
The greenhouse effect is great because we'll be able to grow strawberries in Buffalo.
Exactly. Same
really?
Logic.
Yeah, that was so good.
Well,
all right, Joe. Hey, Joe,
yeah.
Whatever your name is, how many times you done acid?
Four or five?
All right, that's enough. You can tell everyone you've done it.
Yeah. The other thing was I was arrested in June with LSD.
How much?
A whole sheet.
How many blotters are in a sheet?
About 100.
Oh, shit.
What are you doing with all that?
Wow. Selling
I
it.
I was selling it.
Where, at a concert or something?
Just a friend. I was trying to make some extra money.
Uh-huh. How much money can you get for one hit?
About $5.
About $5?
Yeah.
And how much does a whole sheet cost?
Anywhere between... 100 or 300, depending on.
Uh-huh.
And Joe, he seems to want to kind of minimize, you know, hey, what's the big deal? I was just selling acid. You know?
Well, I know, but
Joe, I want you to know, if
well,
you sold
back
acid to my kids, I would come get you.
Because this, you're selling, I don't care what my kids had done, they get their own piece of problems, but oh, I swear to God, you are selling a brain toxin to young people. I mean, the thing you love and nurture is the person, which is the brain. And that's the one thing, that is just short of killing them, as far as I'm concerned. And I swear to God, I'd come get you.
Mm-mm. Thanks.
I'd tackle him before he got out of the studio, Joe.
Okay.
All right.
But the question is, while I was in jail, I met all a bunch of people who were big-time coke dealers.
Right.
People who actually could make money dealing drugs. And they were all walking and getting life sentences. And I'm here looking at, like, 10 years at the least.
Really?
That's weird.
First offense?
Mm-hmm.
Well, first off, these guys who sell coke, they make money so they can afford competent attorneys. You're getting the court-appointed guy, right?
Actually, I did get a good lawyer, and he thinks he can get me probation.
Okay, well, all right. That's what
I thought it was 10 years at the least.
I know, but...
All right, so you get probation, so quit whining.
Okay.
Or stop selling drugs.
I haven't gotten it yet.
All right, you'll get it. First offense. Stop selling drugs for Papa Drew. Turns into the mercy killing doctor.
Part of the other, you know, we yell about parents all the time. That's another part of being parents.
Got to kick a little drug dealing ass every once in a while.
You gotta do what you gotta do.
Yeah, but I guess it depends. I mean, if your kid's 12 years old and this guy breaks in the bedroom window and gives him a tab of acid, that's one thing. But you know, what if your kid goes and seeks them out?
I'm sure. I would assume that. But I'm also going to be pissed at the guy supplying it if I know who that person is.
Well, yeah, you're going to be pissed at them. Like,
he's just doing it to make some money. He is preying on his friends with poisons. Come on.
What
so
about
he can make some money. It's ridiculous. They're ridiculous, Adam. Come on.
What's the Wiener Schnitzel do?
Doesn't do what this stuff does.
Well, it's its own form of poison. I mean, come on.
All right, Jade?
Hi.
Hey, you're 29.
Yep.
There you go. What's up?
I'm not a stripper. I heard that.
All right. Hurry then.
I am addicted to Vicodin, and I'm ready to quit. Have been for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And I get a few days, and then the withdrawal symptoms get really bad, and then I just go back.
Well, the withdrawal from Vicodin is the easiest part of stopping Vicodin. As miserable as it is, I can detox anyone from any opiate in about 5 days.
You can? Yeah. I need that so bad.
Drew,
well, you don't.
Drew detoxed me from Vicodin during a commercial break.
No,
once,
it takes a few
you?
More days, a few more hours than that. But your preoccupation with the detox is misplaced.
You think? Because I have the desire.
Yeah, I know you do.
The battle right there.
No, it's not. Unfortunately, with opiates, most opiate addicts want to quit in the worst way possible. They just can't. And the detox is easy compared with staying off the drug.
Really? Because I have in the past. I quit when I had a baby.
Yeah.
That was easy because I didn't want to damage, the
baby's
health.
And you stayed off it, and then what'd you do?
Went back on.
Yeah, and that's the problem.
I have a legitimate reason for it.
Well, then you're not. Then you're going to go back on it again.
No, I can do because I had surgery recently.
All right. Well, baby, you got it all wrapped up. Then you got all the answers.
No, I need.
What do you need us for?
I need to get past the withdrawals.
Jade, you don't. You're wasting your time if you just focus on the withdrawal.
Okay, what should I focus on?
The recovery from the addiction.
Okay.
And you need to spend preferably a couple of weeks in a program.
Okay.
The withdrawal will be the smallest part of the challenge.
Okay.
And,
I'm all for that, need to know, what type of program?
An addiction recovery program. There's several in your area. Glendale Adventist has one. Las Encinas has one.
Okay, Glendale.
How many a day are you taking?
I used to, take, actually I was doing worse than Vicodin. I was doing something called Norco, which is equivalent to two regular Vicodins. When you take two, that's four. I mean, it was terrible.
Right.
I would take, 6 to 8 a day. And then recently, I wanted to quit. But I was getting sick, so I was having one in the morning, which didn't do anything for me, but except kept me from getting sick, and then would have one in the evening, and none at work or anything like that.
I'm gonna take a wild guess. You somewhere near the Burbank Airport?
Uh-huh. You hear that, huh?
Yeah.
Yep.
You got that Piper cup coming down.
Yeah.
Basically on your porch.
So I know I have willpower because I
Jade,
have...
Jade, willpower has nothing to do with this disease. The only place for willpower to be useful is to get your ass to meetings and to listen to what people tell you to do. That's where will is useful. Otherwise, this is a disorder of the willpower. It's completely overwhelmed by the drives that the opiates cause, and it's easily overwhelmed.
Yeah, and by the way, when you're addicted to something and you start breaking down the different elements, which is, you know, I know I have drive, I know I have willpower, and I know I have staying power. And, you know, it's like, listen, you're hooked. Get into a program.
Yeah, and
you're calling Drew, that's what he's telling
and
you.
And addiction is a biology that's well understood now. And if you don't believe you're an addict, well, then stop. And if you can't stop, then it's a very powerful biology that requires intensive treatment.
That's right. And Drew's laughing all the way to the bank.
Randolph?
Hey.
Hey, you're 30. What's up?
I'm a chronic gambler.
Mm-hmm.
And I work at a racetrack.
Mm-hmm.
Good planning.
Yeah. Hey, I punch out tickets for other people. I literally handle the money that the track takes in. And the temptation is there. Oh, I get numbers all day long. Everybody, dollar trifecta box, 145. Dollar exacta box, 145. And I keep punching these tickets out, and I think, yeah, 145. And then something tells me, bet the 145. And then I just watch the 7, a 50-to-1 long shot, come ahead of everybody. I'm like, okay, I just made a $20 contribution to the state of Kentucky.
All right, cut. Hold on a second. Randolph?
Yeah.
I want to try that scene again. this time, now remember, Randolph is a guy who works at the track, and he's got a gambling problem, but he's a likable guy. Let's try it again this time. Take a breath and pace it down just a little bit, and let's have fun with it.
A little angrier. Right? And a little angrier, too. So he's lost that money.
Take it from him, a gambler works at the track. And action.
I'm frustrated. I hate losing.
It really did seem like he was kind of reading something from a play,
yeah.
Didn't it, at
the
beginning?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So
145. Definitely 145.
You're losing money.
Yeah.
You're addicted to gambling. You addicted to anything else?
Well, I enjoy the occasional joint every now and then.
Mm-hmm. Had you been addicted to anything else?
Benadryls.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else?
That's about it.
You sound like somebody who has some real obsessive compulsive qualities.
Oh, yeah.
Do you do any other...
Definitely obsessive compulsive.
Do you other rituals? Do you think of things over and over again?
Yep. Now, the idea is that I get into a certain pattern. I just know what people are going to bet, and I know how they're going to bet it, and I just punch their tickets automatically.
Do you ever hear voices, anything like that?
Sometimes.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes they tell me, you know, just settle down.
Yeah,
you know,
see.
Don't
this
worry
is a bigger
about
problem
it.
Here than the usual.
Oh. Randolph, you ever talk to a psychiatrist?
I've been trying to see one.
That would be a good plan, because I think some of that compulsion could be settled down with adjusting your biology a little bit.
What are they paying you over at the track?
Well, I got about $368 for 1 week's work.
I'll double it. No.
Hey, I got a great idea for a main show skit for you.
No.
You and Jimmy.
Yeah.
Drive-through bookies. Cars pull up to your window.
You are obsessed.
Right. Yeah. I'm not sure how to present it, though. Randolph, talk to your... Did you put him on hold? Or I closed my eyes. I didn't even see that.
He needs a psychiatrist. This is something much, much more serious than the usual.
Let me tell you...
Not the other gambling addictions or not, but this is a more global psychiatric problem. He's hearing voices. He's severely obsessive-compulsive. That is sort of schizoaffective.
You're insane.
Something like that going on.
Let me tell everybody about gamblers, chronic gamblers. I had a... chance to head on down to the Hollywood Park Casino last week, middle of the week, about 4 in the afternoon on a Wednesday.
Oof, good times.
It is a pretty surly crowd that runs around in that place. Lots of dudes, lots of dicey dudes. Guys with their own walk and their own smell. Everyone has a half a cigar in their mouth and a racing form hanging out of their back pocket, and it's that dude. I mean, I swear to Christ, I looked around that place. I thought, this is a good place for a sting operation. I could round these guys up. I know at least three quarters of them are delinquent dads.
Oh, yeah.
They all owe back pay on child support, and they're out gambling. And meanwhile, this sun is up. I mean, it's 3-4 in the afternoon.
Time to
it's
work.
It's the middle of the week.
Yeah.
These guys are hanging around.
Are they drunk? Are they drinking beer?
I mean, you guys... there's a little bit of that going on, but it's not a vacation. They're trying to make money, and they're not screwing around that much. That's the scary part about it. I mean, you guys who go to Vegas, and you go to the Hard Rock, and you go on a Saturday night, that's something else. That's different. Go see real gambling. Go down to the track. Go down to the dog track. Go down in the middle of the week. Go down about 2 in the afternoon. See who's hanging out. You won't find a woman in the entire place, by the way. Women apparently don't gamble.
Aren't there usually one per, like, 800?
Maybe. Yeah. One lesbian per 800
guys.
But
they're usually some freaked out, talking to herself.
And I don't think there's no gay men either. They're super straight guys. They all look like Jack Klugman.
Gay men are way too smart for that, don't you think?
Yeah, they're not going to throw their money away. They're busy investing it in real estate and laughing all the way to the bank. But it's that real fake kind of laugh, you know. Mm. Something ho ho ho. that high pitch one.
What is?
Yeah. When they laugh to the bank. The gay guys. Do they protest too much?
Yeah.
Julie?
Hi.
You're 20. What's up?
Yeah. I am a full-time college student and I also have a part-time job and I smoke pot every day, really consistently. Mm-hmm. And I'm just wondering, should I be worried about that since it's not really changing my lifestyle? It's not hurting, like,
well, when do you smoke the weed?
Normally at nighttime.
Bedtime?
Yeah.
Normally?
Huh?
Always at night or sometimes in the morning?
Sometimes. Not in the morning. It's not like when I wake up, but sometimes late afternoon and almost always at night.
So it's a couple times a day.
Once or twice a week, a couple times a day, but...
Listen, for me, whatever drugs you do or booze you do or whatever it is you do, hey, if you can do it at night when you're done with a good productive day of school and work, well, I'm all right with that. I mean, as long as it's not heroin.
Well, I got to tell you that a significant number of alcoholics that I've treated, and I would dare say some of the marijuana addicts, start using these drugs to go to sleep. That's where they start.
I started in high school pretty much like for recreation.
Julie, if you're a marijuana addict, you start POW because it's so powerfully euphoric. The second or third time you get high.
Uh-huh.
And, man, that's it. That's all you can think about from then on. And you will use it either a lot or moderately or just daily for years and years and years. And it will take many years before the consequences will start to come to bear. You'll start getting depressed, becoming irritable, having problems with memory, and that will come. That will come.
Do you want to quit?
Julie,
you don't want to quit right now.
No,
and that's fine. And it's good, but know that there will come a time when you will really have to take this very seriously.
Okay.
Because it doesn't stop. It does not stop. This is something that has to be treated.
Hey, Julie.
Yeah.
In the meantime, can you treat it like the reward that you give yourself at the end of a long day and not in the middle of it?
Yeah. Well, normally that's kind of how I feel. I feel like as long as I'm doing well in school and I keep a good job, I'm not too stressed about the effects of it at the moment. Mm-hmm. So I kind of just do it before I go to bed after I know that I've...
All right. What do you do? How long before you go to bed do you get stoned?
Well, normally while I'm listening to you guys...
Yeah.
And then I'll go to bed probably an hour after the show's over.
It makes the show better, right?
The significant effects, it's real extreme. What's extraordinary about this drug is how variable the time interval is between the onset of the daily use and the real significant effects.
Yeah.
Some people it's 1 year, some people it's 30 years.
Well,
it's very interesting.
Right. And you take a drug like speed,
it's faster, always.
Yeah, that's like, you know, 5 weeks of doing speed. You're gonna have problems.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, some people smoke weed for 20 years.
Same issue with alcohol. People can control it and kind of moderate it for years and years and years. Then all of a sudden, the consequences come to bear if they have the gene. And Julie's got the gene.
But if you got the gene, how can you moderate for 20 years?
Every alcoholic goes through period. Because part of the
There's that period, but 20 years is a pretty long period.
There's two elements to the gene.
Mm-hmm.
One is, these drugs have very powerful positive effects.
Oh,
that's good radio.
Boy, that was pretty Freudian there. Drew just held his hand up. He took all his fingers down except for his middle two, and then he lowered the
index.
The index.
Leaving.
So he was just giving me the bird. One is, and he was just shaking his FU finger at
me.
Right? One.
We'll give it the old referee sign.
Right.
One is that when you have the gene, these chemicals have a very powerful euphoric effect. They're very positive. They really work. That's why people use them.
Right.
And so that will remain constant. So somebody that can control their use for periods of time will use it because it works for them. Mm-hmm. The problem with this drug, part of the gene also, is that eventually you hit a threshold where a sort of a switch is thrown,
mm-hmm.
and now it goes on in spite of it no longer working, in spite of anything, it progresses.
Right, and that switch could be thrown at any time.
At any time.
So you're really saying that the alcoholic genes, it was like a two-part thing.
It's probably multiple parts, but the first is I love it, and
the second is eventually it's not going to work for you.
It not work for me, but I can't stop.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Good times.
Yeah. Jade?
Yeah.
Okay, so you called about Vicodin 20 minutes ago.
Yeah.
And you had some follow-up question?
Yeah. That was rude. You guys just cut me off.
What is the question?
I want to know what the 5-day detox you were talking about entails.
It entails taking medication that makes it a more comfortable experience.
And what kind of medication?
You need to... I'm not going to go into specifics because it's different in different programs. You can call Los Encinas. You can call Glendale Adventist, and they're... people there that specialize in detox.
So what happens? I call them. Do I have to go somewhere for a month or a week? Or
it would be best if you went somewhere for at least a couple of weeks.
Okay, that is not possible.
Okay, well, you need to call and talk to them about that.
Do they have like an outpatient type of thing?
I know at Los Encinas we won't take opiate addicts for outpatient without an inpatient.
Okay, so that's a no. Okay.
Hey, baby.
What?
Stop busting our chops.
What do you mean?
Because you called this show because you're strung out on Vicodin. We told you what you need to do, and you didn't like those answers, and then accused us of
blowing
you off.
No.
Now you're angry that you have an addiction specialist explaining to you what you need to do.
And he just did, and that's fine, but he's telling me the one place doesn't, and that's fine, so where can I go? Or if I get a doctor...
Most places will not treat opiate. Opiate addiction takes a long time and usually takes a high degree of structure, inpatient or sober living.
Okay, so what are you talking about, this 5-day detox thing? Can I come see you? What can I do?
Call one of these hospitals. That's an inpatient detox.
Inpatient. That means I go there after work?
No, you go in the hospital and you get detoxed.
Jade, you got to call them and let them figure out what you need to do, okay?
Okay, so I have two places here. Los Encinas just got a big no. What about the Glendale
app? Let me specify again.
Oh, my God.
In the vast majority of situations, opiate addiction is not an outpatient detox.
Okay.
Not.
Why don't you...
looking for an easy way out of this. This is a serious addiction. It's like you're doing the equivalent to arguing with someone who wants to put you in a coronary care unit after a heart attack because you don't think you need it.
No, I need it.
All right, then just call the places and get the treatment. I'm going to hang up because you need to make the calls now.
Really? I can't help it. It's like a bad tooth. Jade, you satisfied with that? Jade? Okay. Well, she did hang up. Good. Oh, what a lovely, lovely individual. I'll give her the benefit of the doubt and say that was the Vicodin talking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And, you know, maybe I'm a prick, but you call the show, you want answers, we give you the answers, and now you got to do it. It's not open for debate. Maybe other people have other opinions. Maybe you could talk to somebody. Maybe, but it's not us.
Yeah, here's
our opinion.
I don't do opiate addictions in outpatient because it never works, ever.
Well, do you think if Jade came in, you know, a couple hours, three times a week went back home, it would work for her?
No way.
No.
Yeah.
She doesn't have 2 weeks. Meanwhile, 2 years goes by.
Hey, it's a love line. I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Oh, man. What? I did NPR today. National,
I've done those.
Public
radio. They get at you a little bit, huh?
Well, of course. You do the man show.
Oh, yeah.
Those highbrow guys NPR.
They got on
going
my
after
case.
You.
They got on my case.
Well, then think about who's listening to National Public Radio.
Yeah.
And a bunch of chicks who don't shave their underarms, you know?
I love NPR, by the way.
Yeah, I do, too. But, you know... I don't know.
By the way, every night you come in here, there's a little snobbery going on.
Speaking
of snobbery, every night now there's a label on your clothes.
What are you talking about?
That.
I've been wearing this shirt for 4 days.
No, you wore the vest.
Well, you couldn't see the shirt because it was under the vest.
Well, it's Abercrombie wear. It's bizarre.
Well, listen, my stepmom went out shopping for Christmas. Bought me a few items.
Wow.
Nothing wrong with that.
Well, at least your stepmom's sort of stepping up.
Well.
Kissing your ass.
Listen, everyone should kiss my ass. Yeah.
No doubt.
Please. Oh, my God. So would you shut up, Drew, with
your
labels on clothes, for Christ's sake, when I'm talking? I did this NPR, And it was like they're talking about male voices in the media and misogyny. And, you know, everyone's reading way too much into the man show. It's a funny show. That's about it. And, it's like Justine from Seattle's on hold. Justine gets on the phone, and it's like, I just want you to know that I watch this man show, and it's disgusting. And you think rape is good, don't you? And you're not gonna sleep until I have two daughters, and you're not gonna sleep until they're raped and tell. And I, you know, when I get that, I just go with it. That's right. Yeah, I want to live in a society based on rape. I'd like rape to be used as a currency. Rape will be a greeting now. Well, instead of shaking hands, we'll rape.
What is that monkey?
And you know the thing that's funny is the NPR guys are so politically correct. Oh, no. He doesn't mean that.
You are out of order.
And I'm going, oh, yes, rape, and more rape.
I thought you would go that route or go, honey, what is up with you?
Oh, well, that's 30 seconds into her diatribe, she starts crying, and I was raped, and, you know, and it's like... I said, listen, I watched McHale's Navy in MASH growing up, okay? I didn't enlist in the Navy. I didn't become a medical doctor in the Army. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I watched a lot of stuff. I watched Speed Racer. I was mainly watched Speed Racer and Kimba the White Lion.
Kimba's coming back.
Well, here's my point. All I did was watch TV. I didn't become anything.
That's for sure.
There's no TV show about a guy who does a crappy radio show. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And there was no TV show I ever watched that was about construction or carpentry. So I magically got into the only two things I didn't watch on TV. How? Because I'm not an idiot. I mean, I can even at the tender age of 9, I can make out the difference between fantasy and reality and what's on TV.
So, do you concede though that at risk people or youth are swayed?
No. Listen, there's a certain percentage. There's a certain percent of society that's always going to act out, and whether they have books to coax them, or TV, or photographs, or whatever it is, they're going to do it. They're going to do something.
By the way, I was sitting at the left turn light tonight, waiting to get in here.
Ugh.
One of the three or four left turn lights I needed to sit at to get in here.
Yeah.
And Culver City's finest, your buddies, flashed their lights at me, your guys.
Did they know it was you?
Yeah.
Oh,
they're
good.
Sort of a greeting.
Oh, that's nice.
Sitting, picking my nose at the guy. It's nice.
I got stopped for jaywalking yesterday.
You got a ticket?
No. The guy gave me a lecture. But here's what I want to say, and then we're going right back on the phones. Listen, I wish you could say this to cops, but you can't say it to them. But I really wish you could say it to them. You know when they're giving you that talk? You know, they pull you over or they stop you on the street and they're giving you that talk.
Yeah.
And it's that point where they could write you a ticket or not.
Right.
And they start that talk and they go, listen, you know why I pulled you over?
Right.
You know, last week at this very same intersection, let me guess, someone made it through safely? No. No, we had a... young retarded kid was killed on a big wheel crossing this intersection. A guy like you, about your age, came right through here. You know, they give you that talk, and I always want to stop, and here's what I want to do. I want to stop in the middle of that talk, and I want to say, listen, I don't want to be disrespectful, but I don't want the talk and the goddamn ticket.
Just make up your mind.
Now, if you're going to give me the ticket, if you're not going to give me the ticket for the warning, I'm going in ass-kiss mode. You're right. Oh, my God. Retarded boy killed? That's horrible. I'd like to contribute to some fun, if that's possible. You're right, officer. You know, I want to get... But I don't want to go into ass-kiss and ticket mode. Because then I'm raped. You know, it's one thing...
Yeah.
It's one thing to be to have the ticket, but it's another thing to get the ticket and the rape on top of it. Speaking of rape. So I want to, like, raise my hand, you know, halfway into the speech where I'm kissing ass and I'm all ears... Because I don't like doing that with people, you know? And my thing was, I want to cut the guy off and go, if I'm going to get the ticket, write me the ticket. If I'm not, I'm going to kiss a lot of ass. But I'm not going to kiss ass and get the ticket because I know I'm going to feel really pissed off.
Yeah, yeah.
So I was crossing the street after the auto show, and the cop was on the other side. It was downtown L.A. Downtown L.A. does nothing but write tickets for jaywalking. Yeah. That's all they do. It's just one big carnival out there. Just one big money-raising campaign. So the guy starts... Now, I cross the street with my buddy, and I get to the island in the center, and there's the Blue Line tracks there. And the guy yells at us while we're on the center island, keep coming, keep coming. You're getting a ticket. And I said, no, it's too dangerous. Figure to kiss my ass. I'm walking up to the signal. I can't cross those tracks. It's too dangerous, you know. Of course, it's not. Nothing. No one's coming. No, no, come here. You're getting a ticket. He's going to write me a jaywalking ticket for crossing the tracks that I haven't crossed yet because I'm on the island in the center.
Right.
So I said, no, it's too dangerous. And he said, all right. I said, listen, I'll go down to the light and then I'll come over. And he said, all right, you're getting a ticket. And I yelled, start riding. Because I don't want to get there and then have to endure. Just let me walk past you and hand me the chicken ass ticket. I'll keep moving. I don't want to have to sit there and discuss it with you. And by the way, there should be a goddamn rule about that. I either want the lecture or the ticket. I don't want both.
Did you get the lecture?
I got the lecture.
Did you get the ticket?
No.
Oh.
Thank God. And I love when they tell you that unreasonable amount that it was going to cost you. How much you think this ticket would cost? The guy says, $50. Try 400.
Four?
Oh, shut up. It's not 400. I could kill you. It wouldn't cost me $400. You idiot.
I want our friends to come in from Culver PD.
Oh,
Culver City PD.
They don't write jaywalking tickets here in Culver City.
I just want to hear what they got to say about this.
Okay, but they would listen. God strike me dead. I swear to Christ, no lecture and ticket. No lecture and ticket. Either ticket or lecture. And let them know at the beginning so they can know either to tell you to shut up or stop listening or kiss ass.
Adam.
Well, back to the point.
Adam, you remember that fatigue you were experiencing while sitting in the office?
Right.
Yeah.
I'm all fired up now. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Maybe it's sort of another version of that same energy.
All right. We got to take a little break.
No, we didn't do any calls.
Drew's got to cool down.
Oh my God.
We got a break.
Adam, you got a lecture from
Drew.
From
you
got to
cool. You got to cool down.
What did the program director tell you?
Cool down.
Just tell me what he said.
Said tell Drew to cool down. We got to take more calls.
Yeah, okay.
You're out of
Shut
control.
Up, Drew.
All right. We'll be back.
All right.
How's it going, dude?
Oh.
Hey, man, what's up?
Man, do I hate this song. I am just so done with this song. Yes, please. Oh, no. Listen, Sublime, it's a good group, but I don't need to hear everything they've done. I really don't. They got to be out of songs on this album. They really do. Just bring back an old one. I'd rather hear the Date Rape song. This song, I'm just done with this. I just say it's what, you know.
I never heard of it.
They play it on K-Rock all the time. It's like, that just seems like something you'd play in the back of a bad teen movie during a beach makeout scene or something.
That's
good, dude. No. All right, come on, I'm gonna have an epileptic seizure in here. Oh, do I hate that song. John?
Hello?
You're 25?
Yeah, how you doing, Dr. Drew and Adam?
John?
Hey, John. Oh, John, you're a cop.
Yep.
Good. Let's talk about that lecture with the ticket.
We're taught not to do both.
Oh, really?
We either give the lecture
good
or the ticket.
Then maybe that's good. Because you do. Well, sometimes the cops
add insult into injury.
The what municipality do you work for?
I'm working right now, so I don't want to say.
All right.
What state?
I'm in Michigan.
Michigan.
You know what's funny about being a cop?
What's that?
We got strippers calling up the show, you know, and they're like, yeah, I'm down here at Koozie McFilthy's, right here on Sepulveda near the airport. Woo! Yeah, I'm working tonight. Yeah. Everyone will tell us where they work and what their job is and stuff. Cops are like, yeah, I'm a cop. Yeah? Yeah, I can't talk about it. You know, it's like, you guys aren't doing anything wrong.
We're not fan favorites, though.
Oh, please. No, I know. You don't want your
supervisor
supervisor listening to you monkeying around
the
on the phone.
LA Kings can't call us either.
Right, right. All right, so, John, you're saying when you pull somebody over, you don't give them the lecture and the ticket.
No, I don't.
You just give them one or the other.
Well, when I initially make contact, I get their information, and then I'll go back to the car and decide whether I'm going to write their ticket or give the lecture.
How do you decide?
It depends on what they did wrong, A lot of people say it's not the attitude, but I think a lot of times the attitude goes into it, too.
The attitude of the person.
Right.
Oh, yeah. I mean, definitely. Thanks for calling, John. I put him on hold because we're getting a little...
You're going to lecture him?
A little breakup. No, I think you definitely should kiss ass until the time comes when you know you're getting the ticket. Then you don't. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to give these guys a hard time unless it's the chicken ass stuff like the other jaywalking ticket I got that I beat in court, by the way, given to me by those idiots in Burbank who are just on nothing but a big fundraising campaign over there.
Didn't the judge give you a bunch of crap though? No.
In Burbank?
Yeah.
Yeah, the cop was too chicken ass to show up, so I beat it. And whoever he is, he can kiss my ass. Hey, look, I don't remember your name, but. Listen, I want to sue the city of Burbank for losing half a day of work and going down there and fighting a ticket that I got crossing in between the lines. The guy said, you stepped off the curb when the light was blinking. I said, but I'm standing on the other side with you and the light hasn't changed yet. Well, I'm writing you a ticket. I said, what do you mean you're writing me a ticket? I crossed in the crosswalk. Yep, getting a ticket. I said to him verbatim, you're wasting my time. You're wasting your time. I'm going to fight this ticket. I'm going to beat it. That's fine, but I'm writing you a ticket.
Remember the time I got nailed for not having insurance in a rental car that you can't rent unless you prove insurance? And has its own insurance on top of that?
Listen. You leave us big shots alone. That's the message I want to send out. Listen, I swear to God, I want a card. I know, hey, I don't know.
What the card say?
You know what the card's going to say?
VIP.
And listen, I know this sounds like some kind of suicide. I got to do 1 minute on this.
Oh, no. Jeez.
I paid $500,000 in taxes last year. I want a $500,000 platinum card, okay? I want the garbage man to get out of the goddamn truck and pick out the hefty bag I put up there. Forget about the robotic arm. Get out of the truck and pick up the hefty bag. Get out of the truck. I want to flash the thing at the meter maid who's writing me the ticket with my car in front of my garage. And when the guy stops me for jaywalking, I want to flash him the platinum card. The $500,000 club, baby. $500,000. You school teachers, you cops, you garbage men, you paid $6,500 last year. I paid $500,000. And let me ask you a hypothetical question. What'd you rather get out of, 2 jaywalking tickets a year or pay the $500,000? I want to be in that club. That's my club. It's the $500,000 club.
The Adam Carolla Club.
Fine. No problem with that. You got a problem with it? Pay $500,000. You're in. Fred?
Yeah?
What's up? You're 14.
Yeah, the other day I took 3 tabs of acid, and I was like all hyper and like freaking out all day long.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the second time I took it. And this is the second day now, and I'm still feeling the effects, and it's like all day my heart's been racing,
yeah. And
I've just been like really paranoid.
Why'd you take 3 tabs?
Well, I took the first one, and about, I didn't feel anything, and about an hour later, I took the other 2.
Great.
All right, well, that makes sense.
Well, this is a toxic chemical, LSD, and these higher doses can cause permanent disruptions in your thinking and how you feel. I presume this will settle down a little bit. It's not going to be as intense as it is now, but you may get something called a post-hallucinogenic perceptual disorder, which means after the high, you may continue to feel anxious and sort of in a dreamlike state. And Fred, you're 14. These are really substantial assaults on your brain at your age, and it is exquisitely important.
I wish I hadn't done it.
I understand.
Like, right about now.
I understand that you see somebody, a psychiatrist who has experience in dealing with people that are exposed to large amounts of drugs, so they can help you get through this, because it's going to be very uncomfortable for quite a little while here. Okay?
All right. Good luck to you.
Thank you.
All right. Don't take any more.
Okay.
Please. All right. Please. That's the drug. That and E, boy. Those are the 2.
Listen, don't. Here's the deal, everyone. When you take acid, you're supposed to take a tab of acid. You people that are 14 taking 3. It's
14,
crazy.
14 taking any is not all that much better.
Oh, yeah, that's right. But listen, I've taken acid once in my life. I was Let's see, how old was I? 4 days ago. No. I was, I'd say I was 28, maybe 27, 28. And I took half a tab because I just thought, hey, listen, I don't want to freak too hard here. You know, if I'm not freaking, I'll take the other half. But let's not spin out too much.
Yeah.
I took half a tab. It's the only thing I ever, only ass I'd ever done in my life. It was fine, but I was 28, took half a tab. 14, three tabs. Are you kidding?
Ugh.
Michael?
Yes?
You're 15. What's up?
Okay, well, my mother was pregnant with me. She was using heroin and ecstasy. So what could be the side effects to me?
Perfectly normal, perfectly healthy.
When she was pregnant with you?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have ecstasy then, did they?
15 years ago? Yeah, they did. Not the same way, not as available, not as routinely available as now. Michael, the heroin doesn't do that much.
That's okay. Good for you.
It's not good for you, and the babies are born addicted, but they're sort of easily detoxed. They
well, where are you going to score when you're an infant?
That's right.
And how easy is it to detox?
No, the detox itself is easy. They actually don't even.
Hey, I know. Listen, shut the light. That's detox.
Well, you could be life threatening, maybe vomit, aspirin. Who knows? It's no big deal. Be that as it may, it doesn't damage brain, although many pregnancies are terminated with heroin use because of the problems of injecting, and it's a spontaneous abortions occur and infections occur, this sort of thing. But so you make it through the pregnancy. The ecstasy is actually the more serious concern.
Because my brother, he's like a little off. And
yeah, the stimulants are really the ones that scare me during pregnancy.
Yeah, he's 13, and she was using mushrooms on him. She was pregnant with him.
Wonderful, wonderful.
So I
don't know of any specific documented changes from mushroom, but
God, all right. And my real name is Nicholas Silva.
All right, fantastic. Glad I got that out. Hey, Drew, is it extra weird now, or have we just bought into the whole weird vibe and decided it's weird?
No, it is extra weird then.
It is
extra weird now.
Not much. Calling to see what's going on. I have a question.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What I want to know is if I can ask my girlfriend if she'd marry me.
Well, here she is. What a surprise.
Oh.
Kim?
Okay. Kim. Hello?
Kim, are you there?
Yeah. She's not there.
She's supposed to be.
Hello?
There she is.
Uh-oh. Kim. It don't sound good.
Kim.
Huh.
I have a question for you.
What?
It's Billy.
It's me, Billy. We've been together for like almost 3 years, right? We have two kids.
Mm-hmm.
I want to know if you'd marry me.
Yes.
Oh, wait a minute. This is someone doing a voice.
Huh?
That's Engineer Mike from the other room.
What?
Hold on a second. Billy?
Yeah.
Now, hold on a minute. Kim?
Huh. Hello?
Hey, that was a two-syllable job. What's going on there, Kim?
Not much.
Mm-hmm. You like Billy?
Yeah.
Three kids?
Mm-hmm. You got two kids?
Yep.
How old are you?
I'm 21.
Uh-huh. Is Bill a pretty good guy?
Yeah.
Good provider?
Yeah.
Where do you guys think you may go on your honeymoon?
I have no idea.
Mm-hmm. Are you watching TV now?
No.
You playing a crossword puzzle?
No.
You reading that book, Son of Sniglets?
No.
No. Are you in shock?
Yeah.
Oh, you are? Are you overwhelmed?
In a way.
Uh-huh. How often do you get proposed to?
Not often.
Not that much?
Nope.
Like how many times this week?
None.
Oh, none? This first this week?
Yeah.
How about this year?
First time.
Uh-huh. How about last 3 years?
Like the second time.
Second time?
Yeah.
Billy asked you before?
Yeah, but things didn't work out.
What happened?
I moved out of state.
Why?
Why'd you do that?
I don't know.
Stuff like this makes me sick.
So you're just like out by the rail yard and something like caught you by the scruff of the neck and just dragged you into another state?
No.
All right. So Billy's asking you, hey, here's what I'd like to do, Billy and Kim. This just didn't go the way I'd planned, and it's not, I believe it didn't go the way you're going to want to remember it for the 4.5 years that you're married. So Billy...
Yeah.
Why don't you ask her one more time and be just a little more sincere and think old-fashioned. And, Kim?
Huh?
See if you can be a little less blasé about your answer. Okay?
Okay.
Like, I'll I'll do a quick reenactment with Drew if it doesn't work out. All right.
The way we'd wish it to be, or the way it actually.
Well, we'll
down?
Do the last one. All right. You want to be Kim or Billy?
Me? I'll be Kim.
You be Kim?
Yeah.
Kim?
Huh?
Would you marry me?
Okay.
All right. You want to try again, Billy?
Yeah, sure.
All right, Kim?
Yeah.
Let's see if you can rally here just a little bit. I know it's late. You ready? Go ahead, Billy.
Okay. Kim, we've been together for almost 3 years. I love you, and you've been by my side even though we've gone through some bad times and everything, and things haven't worked out before, but I'm willing to give it a chance if you are. I want to know that if you want to spend the rest of your life with me, will you marry me?
yeah.
Listen, if I asked somebody, hey, do you like my new haircut? And they gave me that answer, I'd be pissed. I really would. Like, what's
yeah, that's
with
what
the
you
big
answer,
cause?
People.
Okay, Billy, I love you also. I know we have two kids.
Yeah.
Things never worked out before. Hopefully they will now. Yes, I will marry you.
Good, good. Better. All right. I demand that you both start seeking counseling immediately. I don't even... This is the first... I want you guys getting marital counseling before you're married.
Pretty
all right.
Counseling.
All right. Good.
The kids.
Yeah.
Think of the kids.
Make it stable. Make
good.
It work out this time.
God bless you. Oh, that was wonderful.
Touching, huh?
Lisa's crying in the next room. It's such a moving experience. Boy, isn't that wedding going to be great? Do you, Billy, take... Yeah. And Cam, do you... Yeah, ditto. Well, then I now pronounce... All right. We got to get the kids. We got to pick them up to the movies. Oh, I'm sure just every girl, I think every little girl grows up dreaming of this day. Chet? Chet.
He's trying to make a prank.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Chet. Well, nice prank call.
Chet.
Yeah.
Here's the one of the cardinal rules of doing a prank phone call. You cannot let the people you're doing the prank phone call hear you oversay to one of your retarded buddies, I'm making a prank phone call. It ruins the whole element of surprise. It'd be like...
It's not a prank, I have a serious problem.
Well, hold on. It'd be like if the Japanese called us a day before, like on December 6th, and said, hey, we're going to bomb Pearl Harbor. Is that all right? We'll be coming by early in the morning. Big naval assault. Yeah, it ruins it.
Yeah, doesn't have the same...
No, it doesn't work. Because we don't buy into it. All right, so on. Hey, Chet?
Yeah.
Seriously, do you have a real problem?
No.
Actually, I really do.
Oh, you do?
Yes.
Okay, good. You kiss my ass. Allison.
Yeah.
You're 24.
Yes, I am. Hey, I love you guys a lot. You guys have got me through many a working night.
Really? What do you do?
Well, I used to be a machine operator, and it was tough work, so...
What'd you operate?
Schron's Mills Machines.
Schron's?
Schron's Mill Machine?
Yeah, or Matt Sura's.
Oh, Matt Sura's, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. What is that?
Oh, who the hell knows? What do you work at some sort of press or something?
Well, no, I used to manufacture pumps, like for oil and so forth,
uh-huh.
materials.
Uh huh. These are metal working machines.
Yeah.
Uh huh. You a lesbian?
No.
Yeah.
I've been with my fiance for 6 years now.
Oh, so that's why they fired you?
No, no. Actually, I had to leave because of one of the reason why I'm calling because I have something called fibromyalgia.
Yeah.
I was wondering if Dr. Drew has heard of it and if he has any ideas because I had a pretty bad experience with a doctor from the state today because I don't have health insurance because I'm unable to work and.
What's fibromyalgia, Drew?
It's a syndrome of generalized aches, pain, weakness. It's a very close cousin of your favorite condition, chronic fatigue.
Uh-huh.
Except fibromyalgia is really interesting. I believe that the majority of fibromyalgia is actually caused by a sleep disturbance.
Uh-huh.
You ever gone a couple nights without sleep?
Yes.
Don't you feel kind of achy and uncomfortable?
When I was training to be a Navy SEAL.
All right. People with fibromyalgia, almost every case I've seen, I started noticing...
So fibromyalgia is, let me put it in layman's terms, a no-count syndrome?
No, well, that's probably what you got from the state.
Lazy bones disease?
But it's for real, though. And it usually
Napper
is associated
syndrome?
With a significant abnormality of sleep hygiene. In other words, is your sleep kind of disturbed every night? Are you aware of that?
Not that I'm aware of. I guess I've been sleeping a lot.
Your husband doesn't tell you you flail about in your sleep or anything like that?
No.
You don't. The bedclothes aren't thrown all over the place when you get up in the morning. You don't snore a lot.
No.
Have you been depressed lately?
No. No. They found out I had it because I had chronic headaches and migraines to where I had one continuous headache that lasted for 6 months.
Is it even a headache if you have it for 6 months?
What is it then?
Well, if it becomes your sort of normal state, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, if it never stops, maybe it's not a headache.
It's a headache.
It's
oh, it is.
But I don't understand how headache went to fibromyalgia.
Well, they ran some tests, and they ended up doing different tests on the pressure points that, I guess, test for it, and they found that all of them were significantly sore. Hmm. And I also had a lot of muscular aches, but not nearly as bad as the headache.
All right, if Allison was your daughter, besides having sex with her, what would you do for her, Drew?
I would get a sleep study, and I would get a psychiatric evaluation. Those are two things that I require of people with fibromyalgia to see if there are any other things we can do.
How do you get a psychiatric evaluation?
Give them a phone number and ask them to see somebody.
But how does that work? Do you look at a Rorschach test?
Oh, what would the evaluation be?
Yeah, how does that work? Do they put electrodes on you?
No. It's talk. It's just listen.
Just chat you up?
Asking questions, yeah.
You don't think people can fake sane?
Oh, yeah, but, you know.
What kind of questions do they ask?
Well, same kind of stuff we ask, actually. You know, they ask a medical profile, they ask social profile.
Well, I can make $1 billion doing this.
History.
Let's put them on the phone with me for 10 seconds. I'll tell you whether they're nuts. By the time they get their name out, I can tell you whether they're nuts.
It's not just whether or not, it's what's their diagnosis, which is tough.
Well, there's nutty, super nutty, and extra nutty. All right. Robert.
Yes, hi.
Hey, you're 25.
Yes, sir. I have a question for Dr. Drew. I've called in a couple times about being on Valium and trying to get off. I don't know if you remember me, Dr. Drew, but...
All right. Go ahead.
I got a lot of big load to dump on you guys. I mean, I'm seeing a psychiatrist. He put me on Valium 4 years ago, and he put me on anitriptyline about a year ago. And I asked him,
what the hell's jumping up and down going to do for your depression, bro?
He put me on anitriptyline.
On a trampoline?
Yeah.
Amitriptyline.
Yeah, they call it Elevil. Elevil's
right.
Okay. And he told me, I asked him what that was, and he says it's a mood-altering drug, but it is an antidepressant.
Correct.
Okay. Before I was on Elevil, I was on, Butrin, but I told him that wasn't helping, so he put me on Elevil.
Right.
Okay. And I'm taking,
Why don't we start with what the question is, maybe we'll work back.
Okay, what I wanted to ask you was, basically, I've tried, okay, very hard not to take any meds, and it just makes me crazy. I have the worst anxiety in the world. I shake when I talk. I tremble.
Okay, so you need to be on meds.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Anyway, he's also got me on Melaril.
All right.
What's Melaril?
Melaril.
It's an antipsychotic. It's a major tranquilizer.
I like that. It's got the word mellow right in there.
Well, the Melaril, or let me see here. What was I going to say? Gosh darn it.
You having side effects from the Melaril?
Yeah. Well,
what's the side effect?
Yeah, it says, you know, don't go out in the sun.
What is the side effect you're experiencing?
I'm experiencing, like, feeling a steady euphoria when I'm at work out in the sunlight. I feel like I'm just, like I'm walking on a cloud or something. When people talk to me, it's like they're yelling, but it's real soft. You know what I mean?
So the Melaril makes everything sort of blunted.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it's supposed to do.
Well, what I'm trying to ask you If I'm addicted, because I am addicted to Valium now. I mean, I've been taking it for 4 years. Mm-hmm. I heard somebody say that if once my doctor gets me hooked on it, he has to keep giving it to me. Is that true?
Well, I mean, if he doesn't give it to you, you'll have a seizure. I mean, you have to keep taking it until somebody tapers you off, according.
Oh, really?
Okay.
Once you get hooked on the Valium, you can't just stop cold turkey?
No, you can't. You have to be... you have to be detoxed. And the detox from Valium and those types of drugs like Xanax, Valium, the sleeping medicines like Restoril, can be very unpleasant and can have seizures associated with it.
Hey, Robert.
Yes, sir.
Are you able to work or do anything like that?
Yeah, I have my job. I have a steady job.
Really?
I work for a cement company.
All right, now, because you're on Valium chronically doesn't necessarily doesn't necessarily mean you're addicted.
Okay.
You may be dependent on it. You may have withdrawal if you stop.
Addiction
suggests that you pursue it and you progress and you escalate and you have consequences. It sounds like you're taking the Valium the way it's prescribed and have been doing so for quite some time.
Well, like I said, Dr. Drew, I've tried to get off all these.
But you shouldn't be, it sounds like. It sounds like some people are just biologically set up in such a way that they have to be on medication.
Yeah.
That's the way it is.
Like you said, I've tried, and I just go crazy about my meds.
Well, I'm glad you're on them, and I'm glad they're working for you.
That's
about
man.
The best we can say.
Well, guys, working.
That's good.
It's working full time?
That's great.
Hold on. What do you do at that cement factory, Robert?
All I do is weigh in load trucks full of bulk cement.
That's good.
You know, that's all I do is I'm a waymaster, so.
Is that a full-time job?
Yeah, it's a full-time job.
All right. God bless you.
I mean, I don't get, you know,
get zonked and go to work.
When I come home, see, I work swing shift 1 to 9.
Right.
And when I get home at night, I take my meds.
Right.
During the day, I have a little med pouch that contains Valium. If I get an anxiety attack at work, I'll take 2 and drink a cup of water and try to calm down a little bit. But I noticed all the years that I was growing up, I used a lot of speed and a lot of coke.
All right, easy.
And
I shouldn't have gone back to him.
Huh?
Robert.
Yeah.
We got to move on.
Okay.
I want to wish you luck, that's all.
Okay.
I like to hear people working in this country.
Oh, yeah.
Robert's, you know, he didn't have the world's greatest hand dealt to him chemically. Well, he's working 40 hours a week.
God bless him.
I like that.
Yeah.
Listen, all you wussies out there who claim you have chronic fatigue syndrome or Epstein-Barr virus, please, kiss my ass. Look at this Robert. Guys, he has to eat a drugstore before he leaves the house every morning. He's still putting in a 40-hour week. Please. Michael?
Yes.
You're 21.
Yes, I am.
What's going on?
Between the ages of 15 and 17, I was addicted to methamphetamine. We used to stay up on an average from a week to 2 weeks at a time.
Right.
And then we would, like, fall asleep for about 3 or 4 days after drinking beer and, like, smoking a lot of weed and stuff. And ever since then,
Mike's life.
Ever since then what?
Yeah.
I just been addicted to anything that I can get my hands on lately.
Sure. Once your brain, if you have the addictive potential, once you sort of condition yourself up to a certain level of reward, then that reward needs to be met by something. And if you start not using speed, you'll have to use pot or Vicodin or alcohol or some way of sort of filling that hole, let's say.
I use pot on a daily basis when I can. I mean, any time that I can smoke it.
Think about
I found from methamphetamine that I have a big-time stuttering problem since then, and sometimes I'll get the urge to, like, hurt somebody when I have the cravings for methamphetamine, and if I can't get that, then I'll just go out and get really drunk and just try to forget about it. And I was just wondering.
So who is alcoholic, your mom or your dad?
My dad, my grandpa, and my dad. Really.
Of course, I mean this is alcoholism. Is really primarily.
Doesn't sound like a too bad a stuttering problem.
It's been getting pretty good since I was in the military. Since then, but sometimes, like when I get really nervous, like right now, my heart's going a million miles an hour, and I have to keep rethinking the song over. And
Did you do a lot of acid?
Is it that Sister Christian song?
By
Night Train?
No. Some little John Jacob shit.
Oh, Night Ranger. Sorry. What I call it? Night Train? That's
my
drink.
Did you do a lot of acid?
I did. I did 10 hits one time.
Okay.
Really?
That's more likely. That's where
I did half a tab, thought I was going insane.
That's where things like stuttering tend to come from. So it's really not the speed, it's probably the acid.
Okay, so what should he do?
He's got to get treatment. This is not going to stop without treatment, I guarantee it. Guaranteed.
Well, he's 21, he's ready to stop.
Go. Call your doctor, get a referral to him.
He doesn't have a doctor.
Call a local hospital.
Michael, you don't have a doctor, do you?
No.
No.
Michael?
I have a doctor. I have no way to afford it. I just got kicked out of the military due to
drugs. Yeah, get the alcoholism treated. There's got to be somewhere you can get access to treatment. Go to sober living. They can be.
He can't just go to AA.
No way, it won't work. I mean, I can't say that. Sometimes it does, but this is somebody with a serious enough problem. Polydrug dependence is a very serious problem, particularly by 21. Requires
polydrug means more than one drug.
Yeah, requires a lot of treatment, like 3 to 6 months of structured living somewhere. He won't stop by itself.
Could he move in with you? That's structured living.
No, it's unstructured.
You know, oh, it is?
Three kids, cats, two cats, dog.
That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's chaos.
It's a regular menagerie you got going over
you
there.
You haven't been over there in a long time.
No, I steer clear.
Have you seen my kid? You saw him last year, I guess.
I'd like to come up to your house if you just, you know, threw the kids, the wife out, the nanny out, pulled the carpet up, left everything but the, took out everything but the TV. Now come by.
All right.
You going to do that? You going to move soon? Mm. You need a bigger house.
I know, but we're stuck.
All right.
Brad?
Yes.
You're 38?
38.
What's up?
I got a problem. I'm a manic depressive. I've got OCD and ADD. And my deal is, well, for the past 6 years now, I hold in my poop. I don't go to the bathroom, and I do it deliberately. And I've talked to my doctors about it.
How many years has this been going on?
For about six, seven years now.
He has pooed across that 6 years.
He's
been withholding each of the across those years. And what do you get out of it?
How does that work? Yeah.
Well, I eventually go after, you know, about 6 days.
And what do you accomplish by having held? What do you get out of that?
I don't know. I mean,
is there an experience, some feeling?
Serious skid mark, I guess.
I mean, that's what they ask me. I just say it's like a feeling almost, but I don't know why I do it. No one knows why.
Yeah, it goes with, you know, that kind of thing goes along with OCD, right?
Hang on a second, Brad. Ryan, young Ryan, I hope you're still listening. This is what happens when you don't ask girls out in junior high. You become the 38-year-old OCD guy who holds his own duke in. Now, you crap like once a week?
Yeah.
Do you eat normally?
I eat normal.
And, Drew, what can it do to you medically not to do this, not to move those bowels on a regular basis? You always say that, and I hate that, because the only thing I do well medically is crap.
Yeah, but that's spiritual.
I mean, that's my pride
and
joy.
That's your spiritual connection, you understand?
I'm amazingly regular.
Yeah, I understand.
And you say I get nothing out of that, and I know...
Well, you got your esteem built.
No, I know you crap every 3 days, and you have a jealous, vengeful ass. Rectum. Thank you. Brad?
Yeah.
Will your doctors have you on any medication?
Oh, yeah.
Not for that.
For OCD though.
Stuff, but right. I don't know. I mean, when I have to go, I'll purposely sit in a chair and suck it up and hold it in, and I'll go in my pants sometimes. And
Very stubborn man. Right, are you able to work?
I'll work, but
where do you work?
At a hotel.
I see.
Sometimes I'll have to sit down and hold it in, and sometimes it'll get in my pants.
Well, I don't know the specific theories as to why these kinds of behaviors develop.
Have you heard about this one?
Yeah, there are people that retain stool. The kids do this.
I mean, isn't this a weird adolescent-type behavior?
This is aside from being masochistic, it's sort of a developmental arrest symptom.
Anything happen to you when you were little?
I wasn't raped or anything, but I had a sexual encounter with a 16-year-old when I was 13.
Yeah.
He made me, you know, like give him blowjobs and stuff like that.
All right.
We would bet even more.
Maybe something.
Yeah, more went on.
All right, so hey, Brad.
Yeah.
You're 38. You're not even 40 yet. How about seeing about salvaging your life? I mean, you take your medication. You realize this. Bowel movement thing is a strange thing. How about just taking a dump when you got to take one? I mean, I know wouldn't.
I don't want to.
I know you don't want to, but I don't want to do anything. I still do something. I mean, I know I can't talk crazy people out of being crazy, but Brad, you know you're a little crazy, right?
Right.
And one of the things that makes you crazy is you take a crap once a week.
Yeah.
How about engaging in some behaviors that sane people might partake in, like crapping?
It's kind of like an eating disorder, you know, that you do get something out of this, albeit dysfunctional. And it's a natural function. It's something that needs structure to it. And it really requires you letting go of that control and going ahead and having whatever feelings you're containing by going through this or whatever sorts of arousal benefits you're getting out of it. and just going, you know, the same time every day, sitting down and letting go and being much more structured with it, so you don't get into that sort of cycle of preoccupation and obsession.
Hold on. I'm going to change Brad's life. Brad?
Yeah.
Why don't you get yourself one of those toilet seats that squirts in the ass like I got? You'll be begging to Duke.
He'll never leave.
I hear you.
You'll be camped on the toilet like Elvis. Listen, crazy guy. You take your couple of craps a week from being sane.
It's like an eating disorder. Eating disorder,
just do it.
Eating disorder patients eat.
Coddle them. Just do it.
Eat very structured meals throughout the day.
I understand.
You've got to be structured with the toilet.
Okay, listen. Here's your tall order. Take a crap. How tall a order is that? Just do it, would you? I know you're nuts, but do it. Then you won't be nuts because you'll be acting sane. It's my new thing now.
Can you give that lecture again tonight?
I don't care how nuts all of you are. Just act sane and you will not be nuts. You can be nuts inside, but you will not be nuts on the outside. We'll never know.
You'll never know, and that's what's important.
That's the important thing. All right, Drew, number two?
Well, number one, let's go.
What do you say? Is a little homage to Brad? See if you can squeeze one off?
Together?
Yes. Oh. One cheek per seat.
Let's go.
You know what I'm saying out there?
Adam and Dr. Drew.
Hey, it's the Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Kiddies, I got to talk for just one second here. Drew, we've had guests the last few nights. I've been here. I haven't been able to vent. Touched on it a little bit, but haven't really gotten into it.
All right, here we go.
I know I'm not supposed to talk on this show anymore, but gives a rat's ass? It's Thursday, and we don't have a guest, and I've been pent up. I got back from New Orleans, Louisiana, where I was there for the fabulous Mardi Gras.
You were in great shape.
And average time I went to bed, 6 a.m.
Nice.
But here's the thing. And like I said, this is stuff we talked about briefly during the week when I got back, but I'd like to get into it for just a couple of minutes here. I really realize what a police state we're living in Los Angeles.
Oh, yeah.
How the LAPDs and the sheriff in the West Side, it's basically Nazis on wheels. They really are. Yeah. And how we all buy into it. It doesn't make them bad guys. It doesn't make the officers bad guys. It makes the guys who are setting the agenda and the policies bad guys. And how, as tax-paying, law-abiding citizens, we're oftentimes sort of scared and intimidated. I mean, I've driven in my car with a joint under the seat, freaking out that I was going to get pulled over before. I've cracked a beer while I was at the beach, looking over my shoulder every 3 seconds. Every time a cop car pulls up next to me, I go the same speed that he goes. If the speed limit's 35 and he's going 17 miles an hour, I go 17.
Right.
I turn the radio down. I'm scared I'm going to get pulled over because I don't have a front license plate.
You park your car 2 inches off your driveway.
Make sure you turn your wheel in so you don't get a ticket if you're up on a hill. Yeah. Even if it's a slight incline, make sure the wheel is turned in.
The wheel's got to touch the curb, too.
Yeah. And after getting back from New Orleans, where I see guys riding around on motorcycles with no helmets, I see guys driving around in cars with no seatbelts on. I'm on a parade where I'm throwing a metric ton of beads at kids from 250 feet away. Essentially, one lawsuit after the next as they wing those metal pogs and throw the beads off the float. I see people walking up and down the street all night long with hurricanes and Mai Tais and tall boys in their hands. And you know what? If some guy's got to take a leak real bad, he goes in an alley and takes a leak. And you know what? There's no such thing as jaywalking over there either. And as I drove around with this cab driver, I saw him pass a cop. Cop was going 35. We blew by him doing 45. I thought we're on the lam. I was scared for the guy. Put your seatbelt on. Look out. He's going to get us. He said, nah, he's not worried about us. I said, why not? He's going after criminals. Not worried about us. I'm a guy driving a cab. And I thought, yes, it must be nice. It must be nice to be able to go to the beach or the lake and crack a beer without the Gestapo coming by and telling you to dump it out. I understand there's people and troublemakers and all that, but you know how they work in other cities? You jaywalk and you run in front of traffic, maybe they'll write you a ticket. You jaywalk when there's no one around, they don't write you a ticket. Why? No crime. No danger. You're drunk. You're urinating on your campfire and you're screaming, howling at the moon, you might get an open container ticket in Louisiana.
But you're just sitting on the beach, watching the tide roll in and unwinding, drinking a Lowenbrow. You ain't getting a ticket. What's wrong with that? Why can't we have that here? Why do we have such a police state in L.A. of all places? I mean, you arguably one of the more progressive places on the planet, Los Angeles, and we really have a sort of police state when it comes to the cops. And we really do. I mean, you got to go abroad. I was like, you know, I was like a little kid, and I was like, oh, that guy's driving. He doesn't have a helmet on. He's going to get into trouble.
Yeah, pops.
Oh, look at him. He had no seatbelt. He's going to get into trouble. And I realized, wait a minute, these are adults who've made a decision to either not wear a seatbelt or not wear a helmet or carry a beer as they walk down the street, and it seems to be working out okay for them. What is that? How did L.A. get this way? Why are we more uptight than all these uptight? You know, you can't, I was just talking to a guy that you can't export like dildos and vibrators into Alabama. You can't do that in Alabama. But if you want to go fishing and crack a beer, if you want to go to the lake and crack a beer, no problem. Why are we this way? Why is L.A. this way? We got more debauchery in this city than almost any other city. Why are we so freaked out about with the cops in this town? What is that? Why do we write 10 billion jaywalking tickets in this town and no other city seems to care? What happened? Can we start refocusing people? Let's start busting criminals. All right, Drew, thanks. I can see you're behind me 110%.
Think about refocusing, that's all.
Refocusing what?
I'm behind you.
Yeah,
I listen to the jaywalking and the meter maid stuff, but it makes them.
Well, what's with the chicken ass stuff? Or what are you trying to do? Piss off all the taxpayers so we leave town? Is that the plan? It's just I see one of those meter maids coming up my goddamn hill every night at 1 in the morning. Where the hell are you going? Get the hell back down there! You going up to bust the taxpayers? Great plan. Just keep squeezing everybody. That's great. Great, well, I'll be scared to leave the house. How about, can I crack a beer in my living room? Am I allowed to smoke a joint in my kitchen? Are you going to sign me somebody? Listen, you guys, you bus criminals! That's it. Not jaywalkers. Not guys with beer. Jesus Christ. These meter maids. Ugh! And kill all of them. Swear to Christ, you pathetic worms. Have some pride.
Mike?
We tried to talk to Mike twice.
Yeah.
All right. Wait a minute. Chelsea?
Yes.
You're 25.
Yes, I am.
What's up?
Well, I have two questions. First, since I was about 16 years old, I've had stuff coming out of my nipples. I don't know any better way to say it. I'm just going to use layman's terms here. It kind of looks greeny or yellowy, and it's kind of thick.
Nice. You ever had it checked out?
No. My mom, she's still a nurse, but she doesn't work as one anymore. But when I was about 16, I told her about it. She said she went into work and talked to somebody, and she told me it was no big deal. But I've never actually gone to a doctor and had him look at it.
Well, the fact that it's been going on for 10 years certainly makes that a high probability that, in fact, it is nothing.
Good.
Are you on medication?
Only birth control pills.
Any thyroid problems, anything like that?
Not that I know of.
And you haven't been on birth control pills that entire 10 years?
No, I started those when I was 18.
All right. So, again, it's probably just you. I do think it's worth getting that looked into a little bit, though, okay. Because it can be infections, and it could be cysts, and it could be, you know, rarely it's tumors, things like that. But certainly, if it had been, it would have shown itself a long ago.
I hope so.
Oh, absolutely.
Your mom's a nurse?
Yeah. Is she's an LPN.
Is she nuts?
Well, if you ask my husband or not.
Oh, she's nuts. All right, baby. Good times.
Wait, I have one more question.
Mm-hmm.
My husband uses Benadryl every night. He takes two to go to bed, and I think that that's probably not a good idea. I think he shouldn't have to medicate himself to sleep. So you have to tell him, because he's in the other room laughing right now.
Well,
tell him that's bad.
Benadryl is sedating, and it's probably the safest sleeping pill you could possibly take. But any medication is not good chronically, unless there's a very important reason for it.
Does he wash it down with any booze?
No.
Oh, well, why are we talking? Listen, Chelsea, tell him to get on a couple glasses of red wine.
Oh, there we go.
Maybe exercise more during the day.
There we go, instead of nap.
There you go.
All right, Chelsea.
Thanks.
Good luck with them nipples. All right. Katie?
Yeah? Hi,
Last night I went to a party and I tried ecstasy for the first time. I don't want to become an addict, but it felt so good. I mean, lately I've been really depressed, crying, waking up.
And with the S word, screwball. Oh, my God. I'll tell you, we really have the world's dumbest callers. They have no idea where they are. Do you realize that, Drew?
Let's finish talking to her, though.
All right. Well, Anderson put her on hold because he had to hit the dump button.
I know. Anderson, let's just finish. We can't start a new call. We're about 30 seconds left. Come on.
Katie? All right,
Katie?
I just really want some help.
All right. Okay. So you liked how you felt, and now what's happening?
Right now, I can't sleep. It's like 11:50 here, and I'm just...
Are you anxious? Are you having panic attacks?
Hold on. What is it, noon over here? Where are we?
No, it's just I'm really jittery, and everyone at the party tried it, and I was like, might as well I try it, too. I tried it, felt great, but now I'm coming down, and...
Okay.
And I can't sleep.
Yeah, panic, sleep disturbances, depression, these are what happened from that drug.
It'll wear right off, yeah.
Well, but you've been depressed, and this can exacerbate that. Why don't you get your depression taken care of? That's why you can't sleep, probably.
Okay, and it's just I don't want to do anything stupid because all this
like
stuff
what?
Has been happening in my...
Do anything stupid like what?
Oh, my parents want to get a referral on my best friend to keep her away from me and stuff.
Yeah, but you don't want to do anything stupid like what?
Suicide, because I actually have been thinking about that lately.
Right. So you have a life-threatening problem here. You must get it taken care of.
So I should go see a counselor?
Yeah.
You must.
Absolutely.
Listen, if you had a heart problem, a stroke, would you go see someone about it?
Yeah, I will.
This is equally as life-threatening, okay?
Right. All right. Hey, well, Katie?
Yeah?
Get her.
You know our last caller?
We'll call back this one.
You don't want to end up like her, do you?
No.
Okay, listen. You're smart. You got some problems, but you're smart, okay? Take care of this. A little baggage to being... having a good IQ like Katie has, and sometimes you get tortured.
Yeah.
You know, you wouldn't know about that, Drew, but I, as an intellectual and an artiste, know that more than torture.
Intellectual giant.
Forced to pee in my own sink.
Nice.
And we'll be back.
Hello. This is your radio. Loveline will be right back.
Hey, everybody. It's Loveline.
Jeez, we made it through this night without... much more gas. I really was kind of nervous and
that's about all I could do.
You crapped yourself. Yeah. All right, here we go.
Yeah, it's
hey, next week, best of, we got Violent J visiting. Oh, Jesus Christ. Tony Hawk, Andy Dick Mo. Oh my God.
You are an asshole.
He was just talking about how there's no more gas. A huge one go. Woo!
Triumphant.
Oh, that's big. That's big. That's what you call clutch, my friend. That's why I was called Clutch Carolla in high school on the baseball team. Because I would come through when the chips were down.
No talent ass clown.
Just when they counted my ass out, pow. It makes a power move.
Wow.
Sweet.
What other guests we have coming up?
Oh, yeah. Hey, Destiny's Child and Carrot Top and Jamie Presley and...
Jamie Presley.
Yeah, she's hot. Jeremy McGrath, Linkin Park, Kathy Griffin, Shaggy. All the good people coming up. All right, so let's take a little break.
No.
Yeah, it's bad in here now. What timing?
Uh-oh.
And until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla's asshole saying mahalo.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.